The next item of business is a debate on motion 13566 in the name of John Swinney on Scottish Government priorities eradicating child poverty. I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons, and I call on John Swinney to speak to and move the motion up to 15 minutes, First Minister.
Presiding Officer, when I accepted this Parliament's nomination as First Minister, I made it clear that the single greatest priority for my Government would be the eradication of child poverty. That was little over a month ago, and much has happened since. We now have a United Kingdom general election in July, which has meant the Scottish Government, due to pre-election guidance, is unable to set out more detail on the specific plans that we intend to take forward. That, however, is an opportunity for ministers to engage Parliament on views from across the political spectrum of how we can most effectively achieve our aim of eradicating child poverty. I made clear when I became First Minister that I wanted to bring people together to focus on shared priorities. I'd be the first to accept that in the context of a general election campaign, with contested agendas, priorities and political choices, the environment for such a conversation is more than a little challenging. I do intend, however, to participate in this debate in the spirit in which I intend to act as First Minister, to set out the mission of this Government, but also to listen to others and to commit to reflect on how the Government can work across Parliament to achieve our mission. Because the election campaign, and I suspect I speak for all here, will not last forever. It will be complete in just over 3 weeks' time, and we will know the wider political landscape in which we are operating. I also intend to participate in the debate on the basis that I've set out, because I recognise there is a shared desire in this Parliament to achieve the Government's mission of eradicating child poverty. And although Parliament may be polarised at this time, surely there must be scope for us to find common ground on an issue as fundamental to the health, the well-being and the very future of children in our society. So the offer I made to this chamber last month and the offer I made to local authorities, businesses, the third sector and communities remains the same. Let us work together to deliver for Scotland. Let us cooperate in good faith and try to find consensus. Let us capitalise on our shared values and goals, our shared commitment to the future of this country. Our challenge is significant on the question of eradicating child poverty, given that we are operating in a context of acute difficulty in achieving that aim. Over the last decade, the upheaval brought on by austerity, the pandemic, the cost of living crisis, and the impacts of Brexit has escalated the scale of the challenge that we face. We are a modern nation, a prosperous nation. Our economy must meet the needs of everyone in our society. We must build on our current economic performance to create new opportunities to generate economic activity and wealth. And we must ensure that the wealth of our country is used to transform the lives of all of our citizens. Our definition of prosperity must place the well-being of current and future generations at its core. And this prosperity must belong to everyone in our society, not only to some. Every child in Scotland deserves a fair start in life. They deserve good health, safety, education and opportunity. As a parent, the greatest priority in my personal life is to see my three remarkable children safe, healthy and happy. My aspirations will be nothing different to those of all parents, of all families and communities across Scotland, and with colleagues in this parliamentary chamber. My Government will build on the strong foundations laid over the years of this SNP Government, which has seen a transformation in the life chances of children in Scotland. Since 2007, we have more than doubled funded hours of early learning and childcare to 1,140 hours for all 3- and 4-year-olds and 2-year-olds who will benefit most from the provision of such support. We've established a new social security service delivering 14 benefits, seven of them brand new and only available in Scotland, including the Scottish Child Payment. We've delivered more than 128,000 affordable homes, of which over 90,000 homes are homes for social rent. That's 43% more affordable homes per head of population than England and 73% more than Wales. This is in addition to giving every baby in Scotland the best start in life by providing their families with a baby box, expanding free bus travel for all under 22-year-olds, and passing milestone legislation to to ensure that children's rights are respected, protected and fulfilled under Scots law. As the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice reported in her statement to Parliament last week, last year this Government increased its spend benefiting children in low-income households to almost £1.4 billion. We provided nearly £430 million in Scottish Child Payments to families, supporting more than 329,000 children. And we increased the value of all Scottish benefits by 10.1%, except for the Scottish Child Payment, which we increased by 25% the year before. We launched the Carer Support Payment, expanded eligibility for Best Start Foods to reach an additional 20,000 pregnant women and young children, and delivered innovative school-aged childcare services through our early adopter projects. In total, our investment in social security benefits and payments amounted to an estimated £5.3 billion in 2023-2024. All this despite the ongoing pressure on the public finances, of spending cuts, the cost of living crisis and the inflationary pressures with which we have wrestled. So make no mistake, Scotland's action and policies are having an impact. We are making a difference. Through the data, though the data showing the full impact of these policy interventions is not yet captured in the latest poverty statistics, modelling estimates this Government's policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty in 2024-25, with relative poverty levels 10% lower than they would have been otherwise. So it is crystal clear that the Government's interventions are making a profound impact on the lives and the well-being of children in our society. Of course.
On that point, I thank the First Minister and appreciate how he has approached this debate today. I think all of us will be quite grateful to put the election to one side to have this debate today. But what I wanted to specifically ask was around the number of children in temporary accommodation. It's something I have consistently raised. There's now almost 10,000 children in temporary accommodation in Scotland. That has gone the wrong direction every single year over the last 5 years. So where is the Scottish Government taking action on that?
First Minister.
I know Mr Briggs' long history of raising this issue, and it is a serious issue, and it's obviously it cannot be divorced from the challenges around the housing stock and the availability of housing stock in society in general. So when we look at it in that question, the Scottish Government has a substantial record on new social house construction. I set out just a moment ago the scale of the achievement that has been undertaken on affordable homes, and comparatively speaking with England and Wales, we have moved at a faster pace and delivered more projects and more accommodation on the ground. But I acknowledge the serious issue that Mr Briggs raises, and the Government's housing strategy is designed to intensify the development of affordable housing within Scotland. One of the challenges we face just now is the challenge in relation to the availability of financial transactions, which has been the mainstay of our approach to the affordable housing programme. It's why the Housing Minister, Paul McLennan, has convened the Housing Finance Task Force, which is looking at other models of finance to enable us to expand the supply of housing, because that's fundamentally the answer to Mr Briggs's fair question about the importance of ensuring that we have adequate housing supply to meet the needs of the population. So, Presiding Officer, in looking at that performance on poverty, where the Government is, as a consequence of its policies, keeping 100,000 children out of relative poverty, the Scottish Child Payment alone is estimated to be keeping 60,000 children out of relative poverty. Now, that's a policy choice that the Government has made at the expense of other policy options the Government could have taken forward, but also informed and enabled by the decisions the Government has been prepared to take on tax, which of course have created greater revenues to be available for investment in public services and in public programmes than would ordinarily have been the case. So at the heart of this debate is the willingness to take decisions which will be controversial decisions and challenging decisions, and decisions that people might not always like, particularly on the tax question, but to enable us to take the action that is necessary on eradicating child poverty. Recent analysis from the Trussell Trust found that our policies have helped to slow the pace of demand for food parcels, with Scotland the only part of the United Kingdom not to see an increase in the number of parcels distributed through their network last year. So on that measure, again, the government's activities are achieving their objective of ensuring that families have at their disposal more resources that enable them to exercise more choice over their own circumstances. So although there are signs of great progress, I recognise we still have a long way to go, and I recognise that the headwinds that we face are significant. We are greatly constrained by both a historically challenging budget settlement from Westminster and the limits of our devolved powers. For too long, decisions made at Westminster have undermined the ambition and the progress we seek to make in Scotland, and next month's general election brings with it its own uncertainty and challenges. We all have to recognise that the decisions taken at a UK level will inevitably set the context in which we have to operate. This government has demonstrated that we will use all the levers available to us to make as much progress as we can. But a United Kingdom government that was more favourable to our objectives would help rather than hinder us. Our ambition is to ensure every single child in Scotland has the means, the resources and the support to reach their fullest potential. So we will ensure that the government has the necessary focus on eradicating child poverty, because it is the surest investment in Scotland's future, and it obviously touches on some of the choices that will be relevant in the forthcoming general election campaign and decision. The government also, from the start of this financial year, has increased all social security benefits by a further 6.7% to provide more support to people on low incomes and those who need it most. In total, we are committing a record £6.3 billion for benefits expenditure, which is £1.1 billion more than the United Kingdom government gives to the Scottish Government for social security purposes. So we are essentially putting the investment where it is required. One of the exciting projects that we've taken forward has been the investment of £16 million to expand our early adopter community projects. I visited one of those projects in Fife and heard firsthand from parents about the difference having a reliable childcare service and support makes for their family. And yesterday, I visited Pollock United to see one of the after-school clubs supported through our Extra Time programme, which is a joint initiative with the Scottish Football Association, providing before-school, after-school and holiday football clubs for children from families on low incomes. This year we're investing an additional £4 million in the Extra Time programme and expanding to 31 clubs, giving around 30,000 children each week free access to sport and other activities which wrap around the school day. Combined with our decision to distribute a one-off emergency fund of £1.5 million to support councils to help remove the impact of school meal debt on families, we are taking the practical measures to support families at local level. And the passage of the Housing Scotland Bill through Parliament, which includes homelessness prevention duties, go a long way to what has been delivered, or what needs to be delivered, to address the issues that Miles Briggs puts to me. Of course, I'll give way to Mr. Mara.
Michael Mara.
I appreciate the First Minister giving way. Given he's talking about children in poverty and in school and the kind of interventions over the school holidays, I wonder whether he'd be able to comment on whether all local authorities in Scotland will meet their statutory duty to provide wraparound care for disabled children, many of whom are in poverty, over these summer holidays that are approaching.
First Minister.
Well, obviously, that's an issue that we will take forward in dialogue with local authorities. As Mr. Mara will know, local authorities act independently of the government. They have to make their own choices. But Mr. Mara raises an important issue about the support that can be put in place and to make sure the needs of children and young people are met in all circumstances. Presiding Officer, as I draw my remarks to a close, there will, of course, be material issues in the election campaign which are of significance on the question of whether or not after the election we have a government that helps or hinders the work of the Scottish Government. I do hope we are in a position to see the work that I've set out that the Scottish Government is taking forward within its own areas of competence can be enhanced and reinforced by the actions of our United Kingdom government. So some of the issues that I will be interested in that respect, will be about whether or not we have to operate with the two-child limit in place, which of course is a significant impediment to the work the government is taking forward to try to lift children out of poverty, because that measure essentially drives poverty within our society, or whether there will be steps to introduce an essentials guarantee which would lift a further 30,000 children in Scotland out of relative poverty. So there are important questions to be wrestled with in this election campaign, which will shape the way in which the Scottish Government is able to take forward its agenda. We cannot deny the impact of that agenda on our priorities in Scotland. What I've set out to Parliament already, the cumulative actions that we have taken as a government to ensure that we use our powers and responsibilities to the maximum in taking action to eradicate child poverty. But if we look to the United Kingdom government to set a policy direction and a fiscal direction that would enable us to do more and to achieve our objectives. And we will, of course, engage constructively with the United Kingdom government after the election to ensure that these issues are well understood in taking forward the Scottish Government's agenda. But let me close, Presiding Officer, by reinforcing to Parliament the commitment of the Government in this first debate that I lead as First Minister of the importance we attach, the centrality we attach to eradicating child poverty, and the direction of the Government will be set to achieve that objective. I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Douglas Ross to speak to and move amendment 135.66.3. Up to 11 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And I think everyone in this chamber agrees that we must eradicate child poverty, that no child should go to bed hungry, and every child deserves the best start in life. And I genuinely don't believe anyone on the government benches doesn't think that is a feeling held strongly by those of us on the opposition benches. And likewise, those of us in the opposition believe that every single member of this parliament wants to strive to eradicate child poverty. And like the First Minister, I speak of as a father of two young boys who I admit to having hugged a little tighter and held a bit closer in the last 48 hours because of the strength that young people provide us as families in our society shows and has no barriers. But it upsets me to see that so many children in Scotland right now are disadvantaged by poverty. So on the point of consensus, can I thank the First Minister for using this as his first debate to be leading a discussion in this Parliament as First Minister on such an important topic for those of us elected here and our constituents up and down the country. And I note that he's again repeated what he said when he was seeking to be First Minister and his leadership for the SNP, that eradicating child poverty will be his government's single most important objective. And I believe that is a laudable aim. I do have to treat it with a degree of scepticism, because we were promised that closing the attainment gap would be Nicola Sturgeon's defining mission, and that the then Education Secretary, the now First Minister, would not narrow the gap, but close it completely. Yet that gap has barely changed at all. The First Minister's predecessor, Hamza Yousaf, said that he would reduce NHS waiting lists following the pandemic. That was going to be the priority of his government. Yet instead, they've grown. A record one in seven Scots across Scotland is on an NHS waiting list. And a previous SNP First Minister, Alex Salmond, promised the SNP would dual the A9 by 2025, just next year. Yet instead of completing this work on this vital lifeline, it's been delayed by at least a decade or maybe more. So successive SNP leaders have promised to focus their government on defining issues, but have been distracted by their campaign for independence. I will take an intervention in a moment. So the First Minister could set out a very strong and clear signal today that he really means what he says in this chamber, what he has just said in this debate, that eradicating child poverty will be his government's top priority. And he can do that by ensuring that the SNP manifesto puts that mission and not independence as line one, page one of his manifesto. I will give way to the Deputy First Minister.
Deputy First Minister.
I just wondered if the member thinks it's a distraction to have lifted 100,000 children out of poverty.
Douglas Ross.
There is consensus, and I don't think anyone is trying to say one party or the other has all of the answers. And I'll go over some of the issues that I hope the First Minister will take on board, because I took him at his word when he said he wants to listen to other parties. But we still have too many children, too many young people in poverty here in Scotland. So it is welcome that some have been lifted out of poverty, but we have to give more. I'm looking at the First Minister, his boss, who I think wants to come in first. So if I have time, we'll come back to Mr Stewart.
First Minister.
If Mr Stewart will forgive me for just getting into it. I'm grateful to Douglas Ross for giving way. I think Mr Ross and I know that he and I are never going to agree on the constitutional question, unless, of course, he changes his mind, which, of course, you know, there's always a possibility. But because I actually believe that the issues that I set out about the overall context in which we operate, I think, are material, because the fiscal envelope in which we operate is material to our ability to tackle child poverty. We've exercised, using our powers, the expansion of the resource available to us to invest in a Scottish Child Payment, for example. We could take other steps if we had wider powers as an independent parliament. So I don't see these issues as in any way, the constitutional question as in any way a distraction. I do hope in our dialogue in parliament it's not an impediment to us finding common ground, either by it being an impediment for Mr Ross or for me.
Douglas Ross.
I don't believe it is, and that's why I've came here today. I've led this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, because I think it is right that we prioritise this issue. But I do also think we have to show our priorities by our actions. And I think people do look at the statements of the First Minister and others that independence will be page one, line one of their manifesto, and wonder why, if this is the defining mission of his government, why eradicating child poverty is not the number one issue on his manifesto. Is there any time in hand? Yes, I will give way to Mr Stewart.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr Ross for giving way, and I'm glad to hear him saying that the eradication of child poverty should be a priority for all of us. I wonder if Mr Ross will try and persuade his Westminster colleagues to get rid of the two-child cap and the rape clause, which would help reduce child poverty dramatically.
Douglas Ross.
Well, I think the way I'm going to approach this debate, if Kevin Stewart and others will allow me, is to put forward some of the things we can do in this Parliament with the powers of this Parliament and the powers of the Scottish Government. And I think it is right that we look at the issue in front of us today and what we can do to change it here. So let me just say, a quarter of children in Scotland live in poverty. A quarter of children in Scotland live in poverty. So to go back to the Deputy First Minister's point, there has been progress. But a quarter of all of our children in Scotland living in poverty, we have not done enough, we've not moved fast enough, we need to do more. Almost a quarter of a million children live in poverty, a level that has remained largely the same since the SNP came to power. The Child Poverty Scotland Act 2017 requires this government to ensure that less than 18% of children are living in poverty by 2023-24 and less than 10% of children are living in poverty by 2030. Yet we are not seeing anywhere near enough progress on this. It appears that child poverty targets, just like health targets, climate targets, are just more vague goals that this SNP government would hope to achieve rather than objectives they are delivering. The SNP government have the power to create new benefits, and while I welcome the action mentioned by the First Minister, such as with the Scottish Child Payment, it's not enough. The number of households in temporary accommodation under the SNP government has hit a record high. In 2023, over 15,000 households were in this situation, and that represents an 8% increase on the previous year. And as my colleague Miles Briggs said in his intervention to the First Minister, what makes this situation even worse is that 9,860 children were recorded here in Scotland as being in temporary accommodation. That in itself was an 8% increase on the previous year. I'm sorry, I do have quite a bit. If I've got time at the end, I'll come back to the First Minister. At the 2021 election, the SNP government promised to end homelessness and rough sleeping. They were going to end it, yet the figures are going in the opposite direction. So how can the First Minister eradicate child poverty if thousands of children here in Scotland right now don't have a permanent home? And another issue at stake here that we should be considering is education. Now, we've just had a top question on education. On this side of the chamber, we know that good schooling, delivering the opportunity for young people, is the best route out of poverty. Yet, what chance do our most deprived children have if they are hungry and unable to focus on learning? That's why one of my first proposals as leader of the party was to pledge to deliver free school breakfasts and lunches to every school pupil across Scotland in primary schools. We were the first major party to do so, and I was encouraged when other parties had the same commitment. Yet more than 3 years on from the election, when that pledge was made by every party in this chamber, the rollout is still not complete, and there are warnings it may now not fully be in place in time for the next Holyrood election. So can the First Minister or the Government give us a cast-iron commitment that every Scottish primary school will have access to deliver free school breakfast and lunches by the end of this Parliament? Because that is a crucial point, a point where there is consensus, and one I think we all hope can be delivered. I will briefly give way.
First Minister.
I'm grateful to Mr Ross for giving way. I think he sets out a laudable aim, and the Government is working as fast as it can to deliver on that objective. The challenge, however, which Mr Ross has rather ignored in his contribution so far, is the fiscal environment in which we are having to operate, and also the effect of the erosion of the value of public expenditure because of the problem of inflation that we have wrestled with in the course of the last 2 years. So is Mr Ross going to come on to acknowledge just how difficult the context in which we have made progress, where we've got essentially, if we hadn't done what we did, we'd have relative poverty levels 10 percentage points higher than we have today. Is he going to acknowledge the challenges of the fiscal environment, which are very much the property of the government which he supports in the United Kingdom?
Ross.
I'll acknowledge that the Scottish Government now have the highest ever block grant to spend here in Scotland to deliver. Well, if SNP MSPs can say they don't have the highest ever block grant, then I'm willing to hear that, but that is the truth. There is more money now from the UK Government to the Scottish Government than ever before in the history of devolution. But the situation we are finding ourselves in is still a quarter of children living in poverty here in Scotland. And another issue that the SNP promised to deal with, pledged to deal with, is the poverty-related attainment gap. The SNP have seemingly backtracked on this promise that John Swinney was the man that was supposed to deliver. Shirley Ann Somerville, who he's just speaking to, admitted last year when she said this, "I think in reality that is exceptionally difficult, if not impossible to achieve, to get to the point of zero." So is that now confirmation from John Swinney and his government that they will not eradicate that poverty-related attainment gap? And I know I've given way, so maybe one of the ministers, maybe if I've got time, or the ministers can maybe come back to it in summing up.
You have a little time,
a little
Mr.
time.
Ross, First Minister.
We'll go for a hat-trick, First Minister.
I think we should probably leave the footballing analogies for another day. On the question of the poverty-related attainment gap, the Government remains absolutely committed to the agenda of closing the poverty-related attainment gap. But I would point out to Mr Ross that the issue of educational attainment, and every educationalist will tell him this, the relationship to the issues of poverty are absolutely fundamental. So this is the core of the Government's agenda. But again, I come back to the point which Mr Ross has not really engaged with me about today, is the fact that the fiscal environment in which we are operating and the policy environment up until now has made our challenge more difficult as a consequence of the actions of the UK Government.
Nicholas Ross.
What has made the actions of the Government more difficult is their priorities, the way they have chosen to spend the record block grant from the UK Government to the Scottish Government. It's up to the SNP to decide where their priorities are, and if it is eradicating child poverty, they need to deliver that. Presiding Officer, I've taken a number of interventions, so let me close by saying that the First Minister says that he's made eradicating child poverty his top priority. But the record of the SNP Government, in which he has served and now leads, does not give us much hope. Targets have been missed, sufficient progress has not been made, and the focus has been elsewhere. If this is to be the main aim of his premiership, then it needs to be borne out in actions rather than just words. He can't point the finger elsewhere, as we've seen during the debate already. He must use the powers of this Parliament and the resources of his government to achieve it. There is clear consensus, I think, already, and we'll hear more in this debate across the chamber, that we need to reduce the levels and eradicate child poverty that we are seeing in Scotland. But while we all give warm words today, what hungry, cold and homeless children need in Scotland now is action. So let's deliver that better future for today's children and a better country for generations to come. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Paul O'Kane to speak to and move amendment 135.66.2. Up to 9 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I move the amendment in my name. And as we have already heard this afternoon, there can be no more important issue that we debate in this chamber than the work that we do to tackle child poverty. And the desire, I think, on all of us as parliamentarians to reduce those levels of child poverty. And I think I've heard what the First Minister has said about the desire for some consensus, I think, in the space that we find ourselves, of course, being in the middle of an election campaign. And there will be many debates, and there have been many debates, on the approach that we will take to child poverty. So I think it's important this afternoon that we start with that degree of consensus and look at where we can find common ground, because everybody in this Parliament back in 2017 committed to those binding targets on child poverty reduction by 2030. And I think very often watching back in those debates, that was some of Parliament at its best, deciding that we should set a target and that we should aspire to do all that we can to meet it. And of course, there have been many actions that have been taken that this side of the chamber have supported. And of course, you know, the Scottish Child Payment has been an example of that. And indeed, the work at the moment of the Social Justice Committee has been to really try and get into the detail of the impact that the Scottish Child Payment is having across Scotland and the difference it is making. And I think I would reflect on that evidence that we've had a lot of qualitative data around the impact that it's making and many positive experiences. But I do think we need further quantitative data in terms of the scale of the impact. And of course, the government is doing modelling, which I recognise. However, the government does often say that the child payment lifts children out of poverty. I think it keeps children out of poverty is what the data shows. So I think it's clear that we need to have that further data. And I do hope the Cabinet Secretary might reflect on that in her summing up. And on those 2030 targets, I think it's very important this afternoon that we reflect on how we measure the government on their progress towards that. The Poverty and Inequality Commission last week published their annual scrutiny report on the progress the government is making. And I would just like to perhaps share with the Chamber some of what they wrote in that report, because it is concerning, and we should be concerned by what is in that report. They have said, in view of recent statistics and the scale and effects of actions taken over the last year, the Commission's opinion is that it is unlikely that the interim targets will be met, and furthermore, without immediate and significant action, the Scottish Government will not meet the 2030 targets. And they have also went on to say that limited progress has been made, progress in other areas has been slow or not evident at all. The Scottish Government's next progress report can't just point to actions that have already been taken, nor propose small-scale tests of change. And they have also said that such a fall in child poverty rates, while not impossible, appears improbable. I'll just finish this point and then I will give way to the Deputy First Minister. It's clear that the Poverty and Inequality Commission exists to mark the government's homework and to provide that level of scrutiny. So those are clearly very concerning calls on the government to act further. And at that point, I'll give way to the Deputy First Minister.
Deputy First Minister. We all take on board the constructive advice of the Commission. I wanted to ask a question about funding, because the First Minister set out the fact that we're spending over £1 billion additional to the consequentials we receive on Social Security and Scottish Child Payment and so on. Obviously, that's a lot easier if there's more funding from the UK government being spent on social security and on interventions in child poverty. Can we be at all hopeful that the Scottish Government will be able to stop mitigating the austerity that's been coming?
Paula Keane.
Well, I thank the Deputy First Minister for that intervention, and I'm glad that she's taking the work of the Poverty and Inequality Commission seriously, because when I asked her about this when she was deputising for the First Minister last week, I don't think I got as much of a detailed response, and indeed she affirmed again that these poverty targets will be met. So I'm keen to hear about how exactly they are going to be met, given the scale of the criticism. On the substantive point she makes in her amendment, well, of course we have to ensure that we look at our social security system and that we have a fundamental review and reform of that, because we know that it isn't working. And that's what our amendment has laid out, and I have said in this chamber on a number of occasions about universal credit, because it's a system that is not functioning well, is not supporting people, particularly those who are in work and who need that safety net. And we have to ensure that if we have the duty and the honour of forming the next UK government, that we reform and review that whole system, because it isn't working. And it's clear to me as well that we need to ensure that we look closely at what we inherit, because we know there will be a very challenging set of circumstances left to us by the Conservatives. And I will, of course, come on to speak a little more about that as I make progress in my speech. I just said I wanted to make progress, but I will give way to the First Minister.
I'm very grateful to Mr. Keane for giving way. I think Mr. Keane is helpfully setting out the fact that there is a UK context to this discussion. And one of the points I was anxious to make in my speech is that a UK government can choose whether it follows an agenda that helps or hinders the direction of the Scottish Government and its efforts to eradicate child poverty. So can I stress to Mr. O'Kane the importance that I attach to an incoming United Kingdom government actually taking purposeful decisions to help our agenda of eradicating child poverty rather than hindering it, as has been the case up until now?
Paul O'Kane.
Well, the First Minister will note within our amendment that we have recognised that, of course, there is a UK context to what we are debating today, and that indeed we must have policy interventions at a UK level that seeks to do everything we can to eradicate child poverty, because I would remind the First Minister that that is what the past Labour government did in this country by our interventions on reforming the welfare state, by ensuring that child benefits were paid, by ensuring there was a national minimum wage, which I know he was a member of the Westminster Parliament when that legislation, that groundbreaking legislation, passed through, as did all of those measures in the 1997 to 2010 period. So that is what Labour governments do at their heart, and it's why we are so committed to changing and reforming that social contract once again, because I was making the point before the intervention from the First Minister that in-work poverty is of huge concern to me and to these benches, and we must do more to support people who find themselves working and going to their job but feeling insecure. They are not being well paid, they do not have their rights protected at work, and they are reliant on those food banks and food parcels that the First Minister rightly spoke about in his opening contribution. So that is why we have set out quite clearly that we need a new deal for working people, we need to increase wages to a real living wage, we need to ban the use of exploitative zero-hours contracts and end fire and rehire, alongside the other rights from day one at work that are so vitally important to ensuring that people can go to work feeling secure and bringing home a wage that will help to support people and lift children out of poverty. And that sits alongside, as I have said, action to reform fundamentally universal credit and to make it work far better than it does currently. So I think it is clear that we do need to reflect on all of the efforts and all of the interventions that are required to reduce child poverty. And I would ask the government here in Scotland to reflect on what has been said in that Poverty and Inequality Commission report, to look to their own decision-making, which has, I think, created a number of challenges, not least in terms of issues around supporting people into work. I do have concerns, and I've raised them in this chamber before, about the reduction in parental employability funds, the removal of the parental transition fund, and a slowdown rollout in terms of the Fair Work agenda and growing the supports that are available. And again, I would point to the work that's been done cross-party in the Social Justice Committee, which I think has looked at a number of really important pilots pilots and innovative pieces of work that are being done across Scotland in this area. And I would highlight, for example, Fife Gingerbread, which I know will be known to the First Minister and to the Cabinet Secretary because of the work that they take to support employers and to support people back into work. And that is vitally important. We must do all we can to support those sorts of interventions. I would also call on the government to continue to look at what it can do to support more and more local initiatives at the local authority level to ensure that we are working across the spheres of government, because the First Minister speaks about the relationship between the UK and the Scottish Government, but we also must recognise, surely, the relationship between Scottish and local government and the very particular challenges that have been in local government funding and cuts over the period that we are discussing today when the First Minister has been in the government. Presiding Officer, I will begin to draw my remarks to a conclusion. I think what is clear today is that we all want to see action to reduce child poverty. There is a degree of consensus in the Chamber about that. But I do think that this government must reflect on 17 years where they have been in power and had the levers of power here in Scotland, and poverty, child poverty, has sat at the same level as it was in 2007, starting at 24%, and on many measures, indeed, has gone up. It is clear that, of course, that when an incoming UK Labour government will focus on ensuring that we make the changes we have to make so that people who are in work do not experience the same levels of poverty and that we fundamentally reform the social contract in this country. I think that is clearly the action we would take and we would want to take. And of course, we will work constructively with any government and anyone who shares that vision and that ideal to ensure that we take significant action to reduce child poverty and make our steps towards eradicating it, because that is the right thing to do. I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Keane. I now call Maggie Chapman to open on behalf of the Scottish Greens. Ms. Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to begin by thanking all of those organisations who have provided such thoughtful and informed briefings for this debate this afternoon. In his foreword to the latest Best Start Bright Futures Progress Report, the First Minister wrote that eradicating child poverty in Scotland is his top priority, and that he will leave no stone unturned in seeking to achieve that aim. I and the Scottish Greens share that commitment, and I'd like this afternoon to suggest some substantial stones that we might usefully lift together and look underneath. For this is a critical moment. According, as we've heard already this afternoon, according to the Poverty and Inequality Commission's scrutiny, as highlighted by Save the Children, achieving the interim targets is possible but not probable. And work towards that crucial 2030 target, say the Commission, is, and I quote, not at the scale necessary to deliver the transformation required, end quote. We've been here before. Let us at least learn something from our shared experience with Scotland's climate targets that began with congratulation on their ambition, but were allowed to coast and plummet from challenging to improbable to practically impossible, left so late that they were ultimately requiring to be abandoned. We cannot let that happen again, because to abandon these targets would mean abandoning many thousands of children to the pain, the hunger, the exclusion, and the stigma that poverty brings. But as with the climate targets, business as usual won't reach it. That's why the amendment I'd hoped to be speaking to this afternoon called upon the Scottish Government not just to consider the Commission's scrutiny, but to act on its recommendations. Because ultimately, this is a crisis not of shortfall, but of inequality. We know that, above a modest level, it isn't the average income in a country that affects children's well-being, but the level of equality. We don't need to wait for more economic growth to carry out active redistribution. That's why one of the Commission's recommendations is specifically about tax policy, about using the fiscal tools we have to build our children's future. The government has pointed out that Scotland doesn't have the powers it needs to do this easily or to do it alone. And I agree. We need independence to grow the future that children deserve. But in the meantime, there is much that we can and must do. First, we can put pressure on the Westminster parties, especially from within, so it's heartening to hear some degree of consensus across the chamber this afternoon. The new report out just this weekend, the latest update to the local indicators of child poverty after housing costs statistics, produced by the Centre for Research in Social Policy at Loughborough University, shows the devastating effect of the Savage 2 child limit. The next UK government, if it is to have any credibility as a caring alternative to the brutalities of the past 14 years, must abolish that limit as one of its most urgent priorities. I know that many members here agree that should be done, and I'm disappointed to see nothing about the two-child limit in either of the two opposition amendments. There is, of course, much more that a UK government could do in addition, including abolition of the benefits cap and action on the Child Poverty Action Group's call for an increase in child benefit. Secondly, we can and we must give real support to local authorities, putting an end to policies that make it harder for them to meet the needs of children in their areas. Never again must the comfortable win council tax freezes while neighbouring families are out in the cold. And thirdly, we must act here, wherever and however we can, including an increase to the Scottish child payment to £40 a week, recognising its transformational impact. And it is transformational. We should congratulate ourselves for that, but not stop there. We must go further. We must dare to implement effective taxation and targeted spending too, holding child poverty before us as a clear and focused lens for everything, absolutely everything else that we do. We need to know what would make the greatest difference by actioning the work on priority family types recommended by the Commission, the disaggregated data called for by the Coalition for Racial Equality and Rights, and the gendered approach advocated by Close the Gap. And we need to listen, really listen to those who know, cannot help but know exactly what they are talking about. This is not new. In 1999, the Child Poverty Action Group published a book called Poverty Firsthand, based on the understanding that, and I quote, poor people, like other oppressed groups, have a right to speak for themselves, that it is important to ask them what they think and what discussions and developments which include people's first-hand views are likely to be more effective and make more progress than those which don't. End quote. It is time that we began to place that insight, not just in discrete lived experience panels, but at the heart of all we do here. Each decision that we make about policy, priorities or budgets, either directly or indirectly, makes a tangible difference to real children, real families now and those in the future too. That difference can mean sufficiency, comfort and celebration, or it can mean deprivation, despair and no hope. The choice is ours, but the consequences are very much borne by others. It is imperative that we act. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. And I now call on Beatrice Wishart to open on behalf of the Scottish Liberal Democrats. Ms Wishart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Scottish Liberal Democrats want Scotland to be the best country in the world for young people to grow up in, and I'm sure that's the view of everyone reflected around the chamber. But the number of children in poverty in Scotland has for years now been around a quarter of all children. The recent statistics show these figures persist. In 2022-23, 26% of children were living in poverty in Scotland. Poverty and hunger can be major factors that prevent children from achieving their potential. The Child Poverty Scotland Act, passed unanimously by the Scottish Parliament in 2017, set statutory targets to reduce child poverty rates to less than 18% by 2024 and less than 10% by 2030. The statistics from 2022-23 indicate that it's almost certain the 2024 target has not been met. Experts, including the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, had warned the SNP government that it was likely to miss its target, and the government's own modelling said the same thing. The increases in the Scottish child payment are welcome, but all hopes cannot be pinned on one policy. Tackling child poverty demands a joint effort from across government, encompassing housing, investment, jobs and childcare. Liberal Democrats support the removal of the two-child limit and benefits cap. We instigated the introduction of free school meals for primary school children in 2014 and support the extension of free school meals all year round for all children in P1 to P7. Presiding Officer, the Cross-Party Group on Poverty, of which I'm the Deputy Convener, recently commissioned a report into rural poverty. Estimates indicate that 18% of children in rural Scotland are in relative poverty and 12% are in severe poverty after housing costs. However, these figures don't reflect the higher costs impacting rural households and are therefore likely to underestimate the experience of poverty among children in rural areas. The report highlighted that access to childcare is a significant challenge for rural and island families. Difficulties accessing childcare are a driver of poverty and a source of significant stress for families that depend on childcare for employment security, and it's particularly relevant for women who account for the majority of single parents and are more likely to be primary caregivers. This lack of access to childcare manifests in various ways. A straightforward lack of local childcare provision, the cost of the provision being prohibitive for parents on low incomes, or a lack of flexibility from employers and childcare providers, making travel arrangements unfeasible or too costly. The level of childcare provision in rural and island areas can be the determining factor in whether women can enter paid work and for how many hours they can work. This is exacerbated by the cost and frequency of rural public transport options. And in this way, lack of childcare provision traps many women and their children in poverty. Child poverty in my Shetland constituency has, like Scotland as a whole, been increasing since the early 2010s. Figures from the Shetland Partnership highlighted that due to the higher cost of living in Shetland, 47% of people did not earn enough to have an acceptable standard of living in 2021. Even in households where adults are working and earning what could be described as a decent wage, financial hardship may be a risk or already being experienced. And just yesterday, I heard from a constituent asking if there is any additional help for low-income families over summer holidays, highlighting that summer activities and childcare is too expensive for her family. Shetland Islands Council ran a project called Anchor to focus on early intervention and prevention. This led to the creation of Anchor for Families, which works alongside families to assist them to access financial support and benefits and provide practical help, as well as a listening ear for families to express their concerns. The success of the Anchor project shows the importance for families of being heard and having a service that they can turn to. Poverty-related stigma continues to have damaging impacts on children and young people, from feelings of shame to barriers to participation in education. Efforts to end child poverty must acknowledge the complex factors that create the conditions behind poverty and address the impact of poverty-related stigma on children. Presiding Officer, it is right that eradicating child poverty is a priority for the Scottish Government. Yet the SNP have had 17 years of government to make this a priority. We need action, adequately funding local authorities to provide services for families in need, ensuring the childcare sector across all of Scotland can provide the level of flexible provision that families need, recognition that gender inequality and women's poverty is linked to child poverty, the extension of free school meals to all primary school children all year round, and key rural policy to be developed with an anti-poverty lens. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Wishart. We will now move to the open debate. I would advise members that at this time there is indeed some time in hand for interventions, should members feel so inclined. And I call George Adam to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, eradicating child poverty is important to me for four very important, very simple reasons. And their names are Daisy, JJ, Rosie and Molly, my grandchildren. And also for another reason, because as many of you know, my family are from Fergusley Park in Paisley, where effectively, you know, there are no silver spoons in anybody's gob when you're born into Fergusley Park. And that has been the case for generations in Paisley. And it's something that always is important for me, because I know that people, when we come from that type of background, we have to work harder, we have to be better, we have to move forward than other people in different circumstances. But I do believe that in this debate, although we will have different beliefs and different destinations and where we're going, I do believe we do have to have consensus in this debate. But I also make no apology for this being a very personal and emotional speech, because like everyone else, I want the best for my own children and all the children in Scotland. My own children are now in their 30s, and my grandchildren, because if we can't strive for a better for the Wains of Scotland, then what is the point of this place? What is the point of us being here? Because that is the future, and that's what we all want to do. We always want a better for the next generation. And my own kids, James and Jessica, came along when I was a young man in my early 20s. Perhaps I may have been too young, but hey, I'm one of the youngest papas and coolest papas in Scotland. Now, presiding officer, I know it's not cool to say that, because my grandkids will remind me of that later on. But as is the case with most families, that is the time in life when you have your children. It's the time when you do not have wadges of cash coming in to the house. And that's the challenge that most families face. So at this stage, that is when the financial support is needed. And that's why it pleases me to hear the First Minister say that eradicating child poverty in Scotland is a national mission and will be centred, very centre of his first programme for government, because it is important for me that every child in Scotland gets that opportunity to achieve all they can. That is why I'm proud of the Scottish Government has lifted an estimated 100,000 children out of poverty this year, despite the challenges they face of UK austerity, Brexit and the Westminster cost of living crisis. Despite all of this, our SNP Scottish Government delivered an estimated £1.4 billion to benefit children in low-income households in 23-24, while the Scottish Government is still having to spend £134 million this year to mitigate UK austerity. Yes, I will.
Ruth Maguire.
I thank George Adam for giving way. I'm also a young parent at 20, and that's why I support One Parent Family Scotland's campaign for the UK Government to stop discriminating against parents under 25. Would he share my view that that was not an appropriate thing?
Yes, George Adam.
It may have been a long time ago, Ms Maguire, but I remember what it was like for me, being me, not you, Ms Maguire, being a young parent then, and I do support that campaign. But supporting Scotland's families while at the same time the Scottish Government have had to deal with the cruel Westminster policies like the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. No doubt, presiding officer, you will hear everything I've said again from my SNP colleagues, and that's only right, because we should be telling everybody in Scotland that what is happening from the Westminster Government, and only the Scottish Government, is the difference between us actually being able to move forward and have the type of tomorrow we want for our children as we possibly can. The type of Scotland we all want. The opportunity for me, the only opportunity for the type of tomorrow we want, is for independence. With independence, we no longer are the pawns in the Unionist Westminster battles between Labour and Tory. We let Scotland's people make Scotland's choices. Surely it is only logical to progress further and create the kind of tomorrow we all want for all of Scotland's children. That's how I look at it when I see Daisy, JJ, Rosie and Molly. I want what is best for them, and I trust the Scottish people to make the correct decisions with their future. I've been involved in politics long enough to see that there is never any real change when you're part of the UK and Westminster system. It stays the same. The colour changes from red to blue, but Scotland gets forgotten. But this is why independence and the SNP, we can break that failed UK political cycle. Independence is the only change on offer for our children's future. But even with the devolved settlement, the Scottish Government is making progress in lowering child poverty rates. Reported child poverty rates in Scotland are lower than the UK. This does not happen by accident. It happens because you make children our future priority. These figures will improve in coming years because of the positive decisions and actions made by the Scottish Government to prioritise children. Policies such as expanded Scottish child payment and all the political parties in the Scottish Parliament should be behind everyone in this endeavour. Now is the time for petty politics squabbles to be left aside as we look to our children's future. And presiding officer, I hope I have articulated why eradicating child poverty is a priority for me. This is a better way for us to build the better tomorrow. But we should never take our eye off the ball. Our children's future is far too important. That future might be the undiscovered country, and I'm not quoting Hamlet, I'm quoting actually Star Trek. But as our children make that journey in that undiscovered country, we must provide the light for them as they make that travel.
Thank you, Mr. Adam. I now call Liam Kerr to be followed by Bill Kidd. Mr. Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm really glad that the First Minister has called this debate, because Save the Children's submission powerfully says it is unacceptable that after 25 years of devolution, 240,000 children are living in poverty every year in Scotland. Coupled with the Poverty and Inequality Commission's report that child poverty targets were broadly the same as they were 5 years previously, and Audit Scotland's report stating the Scottish Government has not yet demonstrated a clear shift to preventing child poverty, which is higher than when targets were set in 2017, this situation is deeply unacceptable. So I commend the First Minister for declaring that eradicating child poverty will be his single most important objective, and I believe him when he says my Cabinet will listen to and work with members across the Chamber to achieve our aim. So I trust he will listen carefully to something that worries me about today's debate. Presiding Officer, something fundamental was missing from the motion and the First Minister's comments, which makes me worry that the silo thinking which has plagued this Government historically continues, and unless it's addressed, I worry that the First Minister's mission will fail. You see, last week, the Cabinet Secretary for Education agreed absolutely with me when I suggested that one of the key ways to tackle child poverty is through education. In fact, in 2020, the then Secretary for Education, a certain John Swinney, said, "Education is the greatest antidote to poverty that we have." And this isn't news, because the foreword to the 2018 Tackling Child Poverty delivery plan says, if we can help deliver the skills, support and experiences children and young people need to fulfil their ambitions, we will together make Scotland the economic success we want it to be, with very low levels of child poverty. Wise words from John Swinney. Yet neither the motion nor the First Minister in his opening remarks explicitly and specifically talked about education. And this concerns me, because unless we think holistically about solutions, including addressing the historic shortcomings of this Government in education, there must be a significant risk that the ambition is doomed to fail. Presiding Officer, without a laser focus on education, things will be missed, like the fact that this Government doesn't collate data on children missing from education, unlike in England. Now, I wrote to the Education Secretary on the 12th of January asking whether she would urgently reconsider that, but I've yet to receive a substantive written answer. In fact, when I raised it last week, she pivoted to talking about persistent absences, and I understand why, but she told us that data shows it rising significantly, but she didn't set out any substantive actions. So on both of these crucial issues that impact children's education and therefore poverty, many will perceive a worrying lack of urgency. And what of those who are in school? Well, the Child Poverty Action Group submission told us of their survey, in which 97% of young people who responded say that food is very or quite important in feeling ready to learn at school, and that hunger has a serious impact on learning and concentration. Now, the SNP manifesto commendably promised to provide a free breakfast and lunch to all primary school children by August 2022. But that promise is broken and delayed. And the group say, in 2 seconds, the group say, for children who are currently struggling and missing out, there is no time to wait. Yet free school meals are not in the motion, and they weren't in the First Minister's comments. Yes.
Deputy First Minister.
I think the member's comments about setting out the wider context is critical, because I did note earlier that there was an absence of the title poverty-related attainment gap
when talking about the attainment gap. Does he accept that the actions of this government in terms of rolling out free school meals and Scottish Child Payment is all designed to try and lift children out of poverty, but we would all be doing much more if they weren't in poverty in the first place? And I don't want to make this political, but you can't escape the 14 years of challenging economic circumstances and austerity, which have taken more children into poverty.
Liam Kerr.
I accept that the government is working towards its aims. I do accept that, Kate Forbes. But what Kate Forbes can't ignore is that this is a government that's been in for 17 years and is in the most powerful devolved parliament in the world. And yet still is in this situation. And my point, Kate Forbes, is that education has to be part of the mix in finding solutions. And I'm afraid it manifestly was not part of the mix in either the motion or the First Minister's opening comments, because he also didn't mention the 2021 manifesto promise to provide a free laptop or other digital device to every pupil in Scotland, a promise broken and undelivered. Presiding Officer, I could list further examples, but my point is this. In a context where just last week the Renaissance report, What Kids Are Reading, shows that by the time pupils in Scotland reach S2 to S4, they are reading at least 3 years behind their chronological age, where PISA scores show plummeting reading, maths and science scores, with one at record lows and two below the OECD average, where Scotland has an attainment gap, Kate Forbes, that remains terrifyingly wide, where teacher numbers are plummeting, especially in STEM subjects, and violence is soaring. It cannot be right that the government brings a debate which fails to give due priority to John Swinney's own words that education is the greatest antidote to poverty that we have. Absolutely. Presiding Officer, we must tackle child poverty, and I genuinely commend the First Minister for calling this debate and setting it as his priority. But this has to be a debate. This has to be an issue which looks at all the factors and seeks outcomes, not his predecessor's soundbite to make education their number one priority. The amendment in Douglas Ross's name accepts the bulk of the motion, but ensures that the focus is on those matters for which this, the most powerful devolved parliament in the world, which has the largest cash terms block grant in devolution history, has both agency and funding. That conversation cannot happen, must not happen, without thinking holistically and factoring in education. And that's why I encourage this parliament to vote for the amendment in Douglas Ross's name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Kerr. I now call Bill Kidd to be followed by Alec Riley. Mr Kidd.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I welcome the opportunity to speak in today's important debate. I also noted that the First Minister asked for a constructive debate. Well, hope springs eternal, First Minister, but you've got to listen to what I've got to say anyway. The motion states eradicating child poverty is a national mission for the Scottish Government, the Scottish Parliament and our society. And that's something I'd hope that we can all agree on. However, I have to say that the Labour Party's proposed amendment actually seeks to remove the acknowledgement in that manner, an acknowledgement that even the Conservative Party's proposed amendment acknowledges. Although I must admit I was quite taken aback by the simple fact that the Conservative Party had tabled a proposed amendment to today's motion, given Westminster's continuing failure to protect the most vulnerable in our society and their obsession with austerity and a promise of more of the same to come, or perhaps even worse. Turning to the substance, if I can call it that, of the Conservative Party's proposed amendment, I'm not sure if it is willfully ignorant or deliberately misleading. I'll say that it will be deliberately misleading. To state that the Scottish Government has abandoned plans to close the poverty-related attainment gap is simply untrue. The 2024-25 budget maintained the Scottish Government's commitment to invest over £1 billion over the course of this Parliament to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap, and that's a fact. Yes, you will. Thank you.
Douglas Ross.
I'm grateful to Bill Kidd for giving way. I wonder if he would reflect on the comments that I read out earlier in my contribution. Shirley Ann Somerville, the Scottish Government's Cabinet Secretary, said, on the poverty-related attainment gap, I think that in reality it is exceptionally difficult, if not impossible, to achieve to get to the point of zero. That is the point we are making in our amendment.
Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. And thank you very much to Douglas Ross for his statement there and question. I would actually have to say that we're not talking about zero, we're talking about better than zero, where people are not actually stuck in a position where they're born into poverty and stay that way for the rest of their lives. I will, however, leave it for the Cabinet Secretary to come back, because I think she's heard that a couple of times now today already, and she will be summing up as far as I'm aware. The proposed amendment also calls on the Scottish Government to use the powers that it has to take action to tackle child poverty, and that suggests inaction so far. But actions have been taken that have ensured roughly 100,000 children are being kept out of poverty, and that is a fact. And let's not forget the fact as well that the Scottish Government now spends well over £100 million a year to mitigate the effects of 14 years of Tory austerity, including cruel UK government policies like the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. The UK's own Department for Work and Pension Research found that only 1 year into its introduction, the bedroom tax had forced the poorest in our society to cut back on food and pushed over 500,000 tenants into rent arrears and the potential threat of homelessness. Described at the time as the Tories' latest war on the weapon in the war on the poor, it's imagine its impact 10 years on from now, if you can. The gall I mentioned earlier is eclipsed only by the frankly incomprehensible reference to the positive impact that EU structural funds can play in tackling child poverty. This from a party that campaigned for a disastrous hard Brexit and has continually demonised the EU and its institutions, and that continues to deny the people of Scotland the opportunity to reform its own relationship with EU nations. From Labour we hear more of the same, from a party also firmly wedded to Brexit and the damage it has done and continues to do. I would have hoped for more from the Labour Party, which has self-styled itself as the champions of the poor, but more and more we see they are joined at the hip back to the Tories by Keir Starmer. Yes, I certainly will.
Michael Mara.
I appreciate that the member giving way. Does he recognise that? Sir, that's my fault. Apologies. It's hanging around my neck.
Should have let me do it.
Apologies, Mr. Kidd. Does the member recognise that the last Labour government lifted 1 million children out of poverty across the UK, self-styled by the facts?
Bill Kidd.
Yep. I'm not denying anything about the fact that the Labour Party has done things over the years at Westminster. I would have to say, however, that you have to keep those policies in place. And as I mentioned, Mr. Starmer is a gentleman who has no intentions of doing that. I would have hoped the amendment would have recognised the damage the bedroom tax and the benefit cap has inflicted and continues to inflict on some of the most vulnerable in society. This is despite the fact that leading children's charities, including Child Poverty Action Group, Barnardo's and Save the Children, as well as the Children's Commissioners for Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland, have written to party leaders in the House of Commons demanding the removal of the two-child limit policy. Disregarding these pleas, Mr. Starmer has vowed to keep these horrific policies which target the poor and vulnerable, and I'm afraid that no one in Scottish Labour has the ability to actually turn that over, because it is a very obviously unfair policy, and I'm afraid that Scottish Labour doesn't have the power over British Labour in order to effect this. Both the Green Parties, I've nearly finished here, both the Green Parties and Labour's proposed amendments mention the work of the Poverty and Inequality Commission, and I would like to thank the Commission for its work. However, Labour's amendment rather disingenuously uses its work to discredit and denigrate the efforts of the Scottish Government in tackling child poverty. Maggie Chapman's amendment in the name of the Greens calls on the Scottish Government to act upon the recommendations in order to deliver the transformational change required to meet Scotland's targets, and I welcome that approach. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we face a huge challenge in eradicating child poverty, a challenge we should all accept. We need the money from Westminster at this stage in time. We unfortunately don't have the support in order to get that from the rest of this Parliament, but I would encourage all members to support the Scottish Government in the same. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kidd. I now call Alec Rowley to be followed by Marie McNair. Mr. Rowley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When I looked this morning at the different briefings that had come in for this debate, I was, in a sense, a bit depressed, because it seemed to me that throughout my adult life, I have been involved in campaigns to try and eradicate poverty. And when I heard George Adams speak earlier about Fergusley Park, I remember visiting Fergusley Park back in the days of Strathclyde Regional Council and seeing some really innovative projects that were in place then. A project that was there to support women escaping domestic violence, and it was about building confidence and then having the opportunities to access the training and the skills and go into employment. So there has been, over many years, a lot of work done. And it's important, I think, that we recognise that and that we don't always try and reinvent the wheel. I very much welcome the First Minister's statement where he says that post-election we can have, hopefully, in this Parliament, a positive, constructive debate and discussion around how we actually tackle poverty in Scotland, because I would say, as someone who's campaigned most of my adult life for devolution in Scotland and greater powers for Scotland, that's what I always imagined this Parliament would be about. It would be about tackling the issues that impact on people every day in their life, and sadly sometimes we've got away from that completely. I would agree with what Liam Kerr said, that we have to think holistically across government if we are serious about tackling this issue. And I think we need to recognise that there has got to be a partnership and a willingness to work together in terms of the role of government that includes the UK government, the Scottish government and local government. We should never underestimate the role that local government has to play if we are going to seriously eradicate child poverty in Scotland. And we know that in the UK we've had, post the 2010 Tory austerity, and not just Tory austerity, but actually an attack on some of the poorest in our country. And that, therefore, has put us way back for the achievements of the last Labour government. Because I remember, as a teenager, campaigning in Cowanbeath High Street with the union, the National Union of Public Employees, NUPE at the time, who were campaigning for a minimum wage. And people would come up on the high street and take the leaflet and say, look, son, you're wasting your time there, that will never be achieved. Well, it was achieved. And it was achieved under a Labour government, and we now have a real living wage that, whilst not going far enough, does its bit in terms of trying to support people and give them a half-decent wage to live off of. The introduction of tax credits, the working families tax credits, had a massive impact, and as Michael Mara stated earlier, over 1 million children were lifted out of poverty through those measures that took place. And the Scottish Child Payment, which I have applauded and welcomed equally, demonstrates that income is a key part to play in trying to tackle poverty and trying to tackle child poverty. But I would say, going back then to the holistic approach, income is one part of it. But if we're serious about eradicating poverty, we need to look at the other issues that are there. And if you look at Labour's previous policies around tax credits, working families tax credit, it was about making work pay. It was about ensuring that people, if they were able to get into work, actually had a half-decent living, and the difference that made. And anyone in here that goes and talks to people for that period of time that were getting jobs and able to go for a job and were able to get the support through the tax credits, it made a massive difference. So if we're going to empower people to get them out of poverty, you empower them into employment. And as part of that, you have to then look at, for example, our colleges, the holistic approach. So if the First Minister is serious about having that discussion and that debate, we need to look right across. We need to look at our colleges. We need to look to ensure that they're far more focused and that they can support people to come out of poverty.
First Minister.
Thank you, President. I'm grateful to Mr. Rowley for giving way. There's much of what Mr. Rowley set out with which I agree, and I endorse the holistic approach that he is setting out. But Mr Rowley has to accept that at the heart of the challenge that faces us now is the public spending challenge. And that's the issue which troubles me most about the outcome of the election, because from what I'm hearing, I do not see a discernible shift in the public expenditure profile, which is crucial to afford the direction of policy that Mr Rowley is quite rightly setting out to Parliament, but I'm not hearing it from the commitments that have been made by the Labour Party in the forthcoming election.
Alec Rowley.
Well, certainly what I've heard from the leadership of the Labour Party at a UK level is that they will be laser-focused on tackling poverty in this country. And whatever the policies are, as they review and get into office and start to look at the major challenges that will be left after a failing Tory government, a successive failing Tory government, the commitment to be laser-focused on tackling poverty is the start of that process. The review of the universal credit will be another part of that. So I have hope that we will be moving forward, but I also believe that in order to achieve the best for Scotland and tackle poverty, we have to work UK government, Scottish government, local government. We've got to end the division that gets in the way of having the policies that will tackle poverty. But the presiding officer is looking at me, so my time's up. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Rowley. I now call Marie McNair to be followed by Ros McCall. Ms McNair.
Thank you, presiding officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate and welcome the First Minister's commitment to eradicating child poverty. And I'll concentrate on how social security can impact child poverty and also share some of the evidence our Social Justice and Social Security Committee has received on the impact of the Scottish Child Payment. Child poverty is a stark reality for many children and families, and the compassion we have for welfare of children is something that we should define us as a country. And it's clear that the actions of the Scottish Government are already making a difference. Modelling published in February estimates that the SNP Scottish Government policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty this year. Almost £430 million has been put in the pockets of families through the Scottish Child Payment, supporting more than 329,000 children. This is a significant intervention that is making a real difference to the lives of many across Scotland. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, I've heard from many witnesses about its impact. For example, in evidence, Professor Danny Dorling of Oxford University said, "I started looking at the statistics in the late 1980s, when Scotland had some of the worst rates of child poverty in the UK. Now, accordingly, to simple poverty line proportion, every region in England is worse than Scotland." But unfortunately, we have also heard that the full potential of the payment has been held back by the UK welfare cuts. Ruth Boyle of the Poverty Alliance was clear about this, telling us right now the UK system is actually putting people into poverty. We know that 90% of people who are in receipt of universal credit are going without essentials. We received damaging evidence about the two-child policy and its abhorrent rape clause, and how it's directly affecting children. Professor Ruth Patrick from the University of York advised, and I quote, "It is common to hear parents talking about trying to protect their children from the impact of poverty. They will say, I'll skip a meal because I don't want my children to go without. But what we find with the impact of the two-child limit is that parents are reporting that their children are trying to protect them from the impact of poverty. They report examples where children are not telling their parents that they need a new pair of school shoes because they know that the money is just not there. We have evidence of people being in supermarkets with children, telling their siblings, don't ask mummy for that, she doesn't have the money. Presiding officer, if we are to have an honest debate about child poverty, we must consider the harm that has been done to children by these policies. This human impact of Westminster policy is appalling and considerable. CPAG also recently highlighted a case from their early warning system of a working couple with three children who had their universal credit reduced by the two-child limit and a deduction for rent arrears. The family was not able to get a cake or any presents for their youngest child's birthday. and the family hoped their child would be too young to remember this. This is heartbreaking, but these are real cases. And this callous approach that erodes dignity and denies children the basic level of subsistence and enshrines misery must end. And it's not just the two-child policy that's holding back progress. It's other policies too, like the bedroom tax and the benefit cap. We spent £84.9 million on 135,625 discretionary housing payment awards in 2022-23. Helping to mitigate these policies and others. So while we must do everything we can with the powers we have, it's disingenuous in the extreme to not bring to this table, in this debate, the dreadful impact of a Westminster system lacking in compassion and support. The UK government now spends £50 billion a year less on social security than it would have spent if cuts, freezes and other charges since 2010 had not happened. And CPAG are clear that these cuts have pushed hundreds of thousands of children and families into poverty. So whatever party forms the next Westminster government must step up and scrap the two-child policy instead of saying they can make that and the abhorrent rape clause fairer. Trust us, we did good things before, just doesn't cut it now. As Professor Danny Dorling of Oxford University...
Paul O'Kane.
I'm very grateful. Marie McNair is making a very passionate speech, and she referred to the family who were in work and in receipt of universal credit. So would she agree with me that we do need a new deal for working people, that we need to increase wages to a living wage, and we need to ensure that people's rights at work are protected so that they can afford things and ensure that they have a good quality of life? Would she agree with that policy?
Yeah, I'll get on to that. Thanks. So as Professor Danny Dorling of Oxford University has pointed out, the economic inequality between families did not alter one iota in the years from 1997 to 2010. And a reference to the so-called New Deal for working people seems pretty ineffective when the BBC report that the trade union Unite has failed to endorse Labour's manifesto, as I quote, "It doesn't go far enough to protecting workers' rights." I'm just ready to conclude. Every child should be able to thrive and reach their full potential. And if Westminster's not willing to play their part in eradicating child poverty, it's clear to me and many others that only real change will come when Scotland is independent.
Thank you, Ms McNair. I now call Ros McCall to be followed by Emma Roddick. Ms McCall.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I note the motion and the amendment from the Scottish Conservatives, and it's to that amendment that I wish to direct my remarks. I also note the opening remarks from the First Minister. So in that vein, I want to highlight a couple of avenues towards eradicating child poverty that I believe may have slipped from focus. I also want to thank Scottish Women's Budget Group for their briefing for today's debate. The points they raised, that child poverty is intrinsically linked to women's poverty and inequality, is well made. In their submission, they state, in this year's budget, there were several decisions made which will likely impact on the achievements or otherwise of the Scotland's child poverty targets. These include cuts to further and higher education funding, reductions in employability funding, reductions in the affordable housing supply programme, and standstill funding for school-age childcare. They also go on to say it's unclear whether the Scottish Government assessed the consequences of these changes. So let's look at some of the consequences. And again, I'm going to bang the drum for the work done within the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, who worked on parental employment, highlighting how well this process would work, not only to take children out of poverty, but to support single parents and parents in low-paid work too. The committee evidence was clear that work must be done to fix three areas that are holding this avenue out of poverty back, and they are childcare, transportation, and upskilling. It raises the question, how can this government claim to be eradicating child poverty if they don't address all these issues? Not only are they refusing to address this issue, but we're actually moving backwards. Last year, we had Fife College having to close a fully subscribed course at their Kirkcaldy campus because the bus timetable changed and no one could get to the class on time. Surely sensible communication costs nothing. We have Perth UHI forced to look at cutting courses and closing the on-site childcare facility, two of the three issues right there because of funding cuts to colleges. The 1140 hours funding, if it truly followed the child, well, that wouldn't happen. Early years childcare is also failing. Audit Scotland's report found that the childcare sector remains fragile, despite the expansion of free childcare, with it saying that this flagship policy, which underpins broader ambitions to reduce child poverty and to support economic transformation, around £1 billion is invested in it annually, but the sector is fragile. £1 billion, and we're not getting it right, because we find that the offer is so disjointed across Scotland, and parents are now facing a postcode lottery. Some councils are providing a place immediately after a child's third birthday, but others are having to wait to the start of the next school term, in some cases months, before being allocated a place. And a resident in Fife contacted me just last week when they received a letter advising them that they would not get a childcare placement in Edinburgh at all because they lived in Fife, a point that is in direct conflict with the 1140 hours policy from the government. And finally, as Scottish Women's Budget Group highlights, in-school childcare, or wraparound care, has financially stagnated. It's almost non-existent in many areas of Scotland, and the number of child minors are diminishing at an alarming rate. Presiding Officer, we know that a good, encompassing education is a key factor in making positive changes and leading a child out of poverty. And it was not that long ago that this government's top priority was exactly that. And we have heard already that the First Minister, the previous First Minister, previous First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon, stated loudly in 2015 that her aim was to close the attainment gap completely. And it's been mentioned by Douglas Ross that Shirley Ann Somerville, the Cabinet Secretary for Education at the time in January 23, said, I think in reality that it's exceptionally difficult, if not impossible, to achieve or to get it to point of zero. Admitting there, as if we needed it, that for all the warm words on an election podium, it's what happens in practice that matters. I will.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley Ann Somerville.
I'm very grateful for the opportunity to ask Ros McCall if she would agree with me that it is very challenging to tackle poverty in any way, shape or form unless all levels of government are on the same page and, as the First Minister says, are there help or hindering. So the point I was making then and the point I make now is we can either work together on that, including during the next Scottish Government budgetary process, or we can just do speeches in the Chamber. So I invite Ros McCall, as well as doing the speech in the Chamber, to genuinely come forward with costed proposals for every single piece of policy that she actually wishes more to be seen on. And then we can genuinely, you and her and I, work together on this rather than challenging back and forth about a quote. The invite is there.
Ros McCall.
And I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that invite. And I think what I'm trying to highlight here in my speech in this chamber is these are SNP plans that have already been costed, already been put forward, and are actually missing the mark because the focus has moved. So does that mean we no longer try? If you look at the stats, the SNP and the SNP government must have done. The attainment gap for National 5 pass rates has widened. This is in the SQA monitoring report for 2023, which was in August last year. And it states, in 2023, the gap between the most and least deprived pupils obtaining an A to C grade at National 5 level stood at 15.6%, which is an increase on the levels seen in 2020, 21 and 22. The attainment gap for higher pupils obtaining A grades is at its highest level since 2017. Again, in 2023, the gap between the most deprived and least deprived students obtaining an A grade for hires was 23.4%, which is the highest level since 2017. And the attainment gap for higher pass rates has widened for the third year in a row. The gap between the most and least deprived pupils obtaining A to C grade at higher level stood at 16% in 2023, which is wider than it was in 22, and double the gap in 21 when it was 7.9%. I'm just about to conclude, but yes, I'll take
Cabinet Secretary Jenny Corbett.
I appreciate the points that the member is making in relation to the poverty-related attainment gap, but she is comparing years in which pandemic arrangements were placed in were put in place, and that meant that we looked at a broader range of evidence. The attainment gap today is narrower than it was in 2019 before the pandemic began. Will the member recognise that and the progress that has been made thus far?
I can give the member back her time, Ros McCall.
Thank you very much indeed, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that that question. I think the point needs to be made that we're actually moved on from the pandemic and we need to see actual changes happening now. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, eradicating child poverty is a national mission. I don't think there's anyone in this chamber that disagrees with that. But I'm deeply concerned that we will find ourselves looking back at another broken promise unless all the avenues explored, and that's what's important by my speech, that all the avenues are explored, which this SNP government is uninclined to do at this time, and it's Scotland's children that will pay the price. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McCall. I now call Emma Roddick to be followed by Colette Stevenson. Ms Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's felt like a very tumultuous time in politics for at least as long as I've been elected, but that is how politics is. There always seems to be another event. And it's always good to be able to take a step back and remind ourselves that whether it's an election, a pandemic, or Brexit, whatever is going on, the SNP remains true to its principles. And that's what we're seeing today. We stand for independence for Scotland not as an end in itself, but as a reaction and a solution to a litany of failures by successive UK governments. It is a route to a fairer, more equal country that is free to take what we believe and know is the right approach, supporting those who need it most and keeping public services like the NHS free at the point of need, regardless of which family you were born into. The kind of country that can end child poverty. We are not independent, but we do use whatever powers we have, however much we wish we had more, to keep children out of poverty. And whatever else you hear today, it is working. We have not ended child poverty yet, but that is our ambition, an ambition that is reflected in our actions, and the SNP government is currently estimated to be keeping 100,000 children out of poverty this year. Next year it will be more, because we stand by our principles. What I do want to speak about today on the topic of child poverty is housing and homelessness, and interestingly it's also what many of my opposition colleagues' contributions have focused on so far. So I think it's promising that we are agreed on the issues, and my hope is that over the next few months we can build some consensus on the solutions as well. We know that anyone who spends time homeless is more likely to struggle, more likely to experience severe mental health issues and addiction, and more likely to die early. That includes children. We know from shelter statistics that children growing up in poor housing conditions have up to 25% higher risk of severe ill health. Children living in homelessness are 3 to 4 times as likely to have mental health problems, even a year after they've been housed. The longer that children spend homeless, the more entrenched their poverty becomes, and they are more likely to experience it for the rest of their lives. These children's futures are being written before they've had a chance to plan it, and we cannot tackle child poverty without tackling homelessness. The Housing Bill provides us with an opportunity to address this, but its success is not a given. So I hope that now a housing emergency has been named, my good friend the Housing Minister will really look at what is not working and what might work. Because Housing to 2040 is not addressing child homelessness or the speed of rehousing families in temporary accommodation. And I know the will is there, the urgency is there, but the policy hasn't quite caught up. Miles Briggs has made the point that more children are spending time in temporary accommodation every year. He's right, and the First Minister is right that our record on affordable housing is record-breaking. But that is sadly not changing the tide on children living with homelessness. And we'll pay the price for that when those children are more reliant on our public services as they grow up. And those children will pay a higher price of living all their lives with that trauma and those impacts. So I know how the experience of homelessness sits with a person, no matter how far away they may seem from it. I'm on a good wage, I have a secure home, and it has things in it that I used to be too scared to buy in case I had to move quickly and leave it behind, like houseplants, my own set of tools, and my cat. But any time I miss the train home and I have to stay in Edinburgh for an extra night, any time I momentarily forget which part of my rucksack my house key's in, and every time I think about future choices I'll make about studying, careers, family, it all comes crashing back. So I know that all those feelings, all the fear, the fierce insecurity of not knowing if you'll ever be okay does not go away, even if you become a Member of Parliament. And homelessness doesn't just happen, it's almost always preventable. It is not just about how many houses exist, it's about safety nets. People don't give up the roof over their head easily, and by the time they do, they have lost and left behind far more than most will be able to imagine. In that time, they will come into contact with council services, the DWP, Social Security Scotland, head teachers, social work, many others. And we need to take those prevention opportunities. Our house building should also react better to local housing need, the asks of those who are currently registered as homeless, building the types of houses that those people are waiting for. In the Highlands, people are crying out not for 3- and 4-bedroom houses in the suburbs with lovely driveways, but for 1-bedroom properties in the city centre with access to public transport. We've seen award-winning developments like those on Raining Stairs by Inverness Castle, which are small flats in the middle of the city, exactly what people need. Now, the biggest barrier that I've noticed with countless other governments is getting a party, once it has achieved power, to do what it said it was going to do, not to drop its principles at the sight of the first bad poll. Now, the SNP stands here year after year, committing to progress and then making progress, leading from the front and using leadership to bring people with us. So I look forward to chatting to colleagues in Labour, Greens, Lib Dems. Many of us agree that we need to tackle homelessness as its own issue, not solely look at it in terms of house building. And I hope that the housing bill, when we debate it in here, becomes more obviously a tool to tackle and prevent child homelessness. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Roddick. I now call Colette Stevenson to be followed by Carol Mochen. Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The SNP wants Scotland to be the best place in the world to grow up and for every single child to be able to reach their full potential. Crucial to that is eradicating child poverty, which, as we have heard, the First Minister's top priority. Best Start, Bright Futures, the Scottish Government's framework to tackle child poverty, sets out many of the cross-cutting policies required to achieve that, and I welcome the progress that has been made. The SNP Government recognises the balance of action required across three critical drivers: income from employment, the cost of living, and income from social security. And in terms of employment, we need to ensure that parents have access to good, stable and flexible jobs that pay the real living wage as a minimum. We must also support parents who are out of work into the labour market. And the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recently finished an inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. And we heard success stories from people who have used the Scottish Government's employability schemes. However, a sustainable exit from poverty will never be just about securing and retaining a job. And that is why the Scottish Government is taking wide-ranging action to tackle poverty. The cost of living remains a significant challenge for many families. The current Tory-made cost crisis builds on the damage of years of austerity, and rampant inflation has affected food prices. Energy costs are still way too high, and the UK welfare system is broken. The tale of two governments could not be clearer. The SNP created the Scottish Child Payment. The Tories cut universal credit. The SNP introduced the carers' allowance supplement, and the Tories are trying to claw £250 million from carers. And the SNP built a new social security system based on dignity, fairness and respect, and the Tories delivered the rate clause. So despite the challenges of UK austerity, Brexit and the cost of living crisis, the SNP Government is delivering almost £3 billion to support people through the cost of living crisis and £134 million in 24-25 to combat Westminster austerity through mitigations. Presiding Officer, we've heard from Labour today that the last UK Labour Government lifted 1 million children in the UK out of poverty. As a headline, that sounds good. But in our recent evidence session at the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, we heard from Professor Danny Dorling.
that the last UK Labour government tipped children just below poverty line to just above it, something which children and their families would hardly feel the effects of. That economic inequality between families did not alter one iota over their periods in office. And that children growing up under New Labour had stunted growth, a hallmark of poverty more akin to the United States than a European country. So that's the record of New Labour. I would like to continue, thank you. Something those on the benches to my right want to highlight for some reason, and things don't look much better for a future Labour government. Sir Keir Starmer has pledged to maintain Tory fiscal rules and cruel policies like the two-child limit. On the other hand, the SNP government is delivering seven unique benefits, including the Scottish child payment of £26.70 per week per eligible child, which benefits 329,000 children in Scotland. Yeah, I'm happy to take an intervention.
Alec Rowley. Do you, what you actually said there, but do you support the view of your First Minister, who has come here to say that we actually should start to work together to try and tackle child poverty rather than just throwing insults across the chamber?
Colette Stevenson.
Thank the member for that intervention, and I wholeheartedly agree with our First Minister in building consensus here when it comes to eradicating child poverty. So I would put it back to the member, Presiding Officer, that if he was to ask if it was a future UK Labour government if they were to scrap the two-child cap and the rape clause as well. Mm-hmm. Thank you. Professor Ruth Patrick described this as a really well-targeted policy which corrects the UK government's divorcing of the relationship between needs and entitlement. In terms of household income, Tom Wernham from the Institute for Fiscal Studies stated that the Scottish child payment is going to have significantly increased incomes of people who are well below the poverty line, while Professor Dorling said, "What really matters is taking families out of deep poverty. That wasn't included in the new Labour targets." In contrast, the SNP government's choices are raising the incomes of the poorest households, and modelling suggests that Scottish Government policies will keep 70,000 children out of deep poverty this year. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, the SNP's progressive policies are making a real difference to children right across Scotland. The baby box, 1140 hours of early learning and childcare, and the game-changing Scottish child payment are key components of the Scottish Government's mission to eradicate child poverty. However, with Westminster holding many key powers over social security, the next UK government must introduce an essentials guarantee and abolish the two-child limit. These changes could lift 40,000 children in Scotland out of poverty overnight. If Labour aren't down in the street, they should stop trying to imitate Tory policies and look at the positive difference SNP policies are making to people in Scotland. Otherwise, more and more people will recognise that Scotland needs the full powers of independence to build a better country.
Thank you. I now call Carol Mochen to be followed by Stuart McMillan, around 6 minutes. Ms Mochen.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And like everyone who has spoken, it is my view that the overarching priority of the Scottish Parliament should be to tackle, reduce and eradicate child poverty. Child poverty is a huge challenge facing our country, limiting the opportunities of children in every town and deepening the inequalities that already exist in our society from the second a child is born. It should shame us all that it remains as prevalent as it does in our country today. We stand in this chamber week in, week out, discussing the modern, inclusive and progressive Scotland we think exists, when in reality it is shocking that, according to the most recent estimates, child poverty levels have increased in 2022 to 2023, with 260,000 Scottish children now living in poverty. Presiding Officer, this is nothing short of a national disgrace, and we must redouble our efforts to address it. When figures like this exist, they represent more than just a number, but a dark and difficult reality for so many children and their families across Scotland. It is unjust and it is unacceptable. And we here in this chamber, must do all that we can to fix it. Now, I am going to make this statement because I do believe it is core to the way in which people are treated in this country. I've made it clear before, and I make it clear once again, that I do deplore the Tory government's attack on working class people. And in my view, they are the friends of the rich and show no interest in redistributing wealth to those most in need. And I accept that those political decisions made there do affect what happens here in Scotland. But of course, as I also talk about often in this place, we must be honest about what we can do and what our responsibilities here in Scotland are. And quite rightly, John Swinney, Hamza Yousaf, Nicola Sturgeon have all promised to eradicate child poverty. But yet, those promises are broken, and that is to the young people and their families. And we have presided over virtually static rates in child poverty since 2014, and we all need to acknowledge that. Of course.
Willie Coffey, member for accepting the intervention. Is she actually aware that when Labour left office in 2010, they left 3.6 million children still in poverty?
Carol Mochan, I can give you the time back.
And that is the reason that I fight every single day. While there are children in poverty, we should all be accepting that we must do more. And so for the benches in the middle to suggest that we shouldn't be doing more, I just don't understand that. The government must listen to what experts are telling us. And last week, the Poverty and Inequality Commission published a damning report that did lay bare the SNP progress on tackling child poverty. It's been slow, and that we are not predicted for this government to meet its child poverty targets. And I really welcomed the Deputy First Minister accepting this report and saying that she will use that to base how we go on to tackle and take those recommendations seriously. Presiding officers, families today bring their children up in Scotland where the richest continue to own the wealth, whilst those from our most deprived areas work on low wages to create it. And we must do something about that. In a modern and inclusive, progressive Scotland, that is what we need to do. And I believe we can do it, and that change can come. But I do say to the Chamber again, and I do look to the benches in the middle, we do have to think, what can we do? What can this Parliament do? What can this government do? And if we lead on this message, it is only when every child does well that we will all do well. That would be a good message to put out in Scotland. I have a particular ask which I believe this government could do, and I've raised in the Chamber on a number of occasions, and it's around free school meals eligibility. We are waiting on the government meeting its commitment to roll out free school meals, and we have heard about the challenge they seem to be having in this area. But I've been working with charities such as Aberlour, who have been talking about how we can quickly help families struggling, and they believe expanding free school meal eligibility is one way, as a tangible action that could make a real difference to those living in poverty, and it's a change that could be made relatively easily, of course.
I'm very grateful to Carol Malkin to take an intervention on this point, and isn't it right that those who are entitled to the free school meals under the scheme, this acts as a passport benefit that gives so many other additional cost-saving measures to those families. And it is within the government's grip to really push out and actively go and seek those families that are entitled to free school meals, notwithstanding the Scottish Government's policy to roll it out across primary schools.
Carol Mochan.
Thank you. Can I thank Martin Whitfield for that intervention? And I was going to go on to say a similar thing, and I would really encourage the Cabinet Secretary to respond in our closing remarks to this point. It is something that we have brought to the Chamber a number of times, and I have written to the Cabinet Secretary for Education. This is a real change that could be made now, and I would ask if the Cabinet Secretary would even consider working cross-portfolio to get this in place as quickly as possible. Presiding Officer, I don't have much time left, but I do want to say that I hope that the sentiment of Labour's amendment around working people and how we make sure that work pays is one that they would support. Labour has a clear plan for delivering a new deal for workers, and that would make a big difference to helping people come out of poverty. Presiding Officer, my final words on the matter is that to do something we need to have the political will, and I would ask the Government to have that political will to look at what we can do more, and I do thank them for agreeing to work cross-party to get this right. No child should live in poverty. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Mochen. We're going to move to the final speaker in the open debate. Just a few too many conversations being had around the Chamber, and I call on Stuart McMillan, around 6 minutes. Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Sepp Singh-Ulster. Like everyone else in the Chamber, I want to see poverty resigned to the history books, and I'm sure that everyone in the Parliament actually would want that to be the case. We want to see an end to poverty, and delivering policies that will bring about this change are two very different matters. I think we would all recognise that there is no one single policy that is actually going to eradicate child poverty. And so long as Scotland does not have the full powers of an independent parliament, there will be decisions that are out with the hands of whoever is leading this parliament and whoever is leading the government in Scotland. I do welcome the recently published annual progress report, which covers the Scottish Government's actions to tackle child poverty, revealing that almost £1.4 billion has been invested to support children in low-income households in the last financial year. Now, some key policies covered in the report include that awarding almost £430 million to families through the Scottish Child Payment, supporting more than 329,000 children as of the 31st of March 2024. Widening the eligibility for Best Start Foods, which helps low-income families access nutritious food, so thousands more children and pregnant women can benefit. Supporting around 4,400 children through continued work to develop a system of school-aged childcare and continuing to provide 1,140 hours of funded childcare for all eligible children. Providing free bus travel to 727,000 children and young people as of March 2024, and delivering 6,045 affordable homes across Scotland, with two-thirds for social rent between April and December 2023, helping an estimated 2,115 households with children into affordable housing. Presiding Officer, the SNP's track record when it comes to tackling child poverty is further backed up by modelling published in February 2024, estimating that SNP policies will keep 100,000 children out of relative poverty this year. Even amidst the difficult financial challenge the Scottish Government finds itself in, this SNP Government is choosing to find the money to provide badly needed additional support. Now, this is in sharp contrast to the current UK Government, who are funding tax cuts for the rich by taking money away from low-income households. And after 14 years of austerity, this Tory government is finished, with Sir Keir Starmer expected to be the next Prime Minister. However, is the UK Labour prepared to change the wallpaper in Downing Street? I pose this question to them. What is the point in Labour replacing the Tories if the red rosette offers nothing different than the blue? Now, the First Minister has made eradicating child poverty his top priority. But Westminster policies like the two-child limit, which Sir Keir Starmer has refused to commit to scrapping, also hampers the SNP Scottish Government's progress. We've also got the bankers' bonuses, which Labour, Carol Mockin spoke about different policies, Labour have suggested they're going to support that as well. Now, Presiding Officer, after his election, the First Minister wrote to Sir Keir Starmer on the 12th of May, requesting a meeting to discuss shared goals and values in tackling child poverty. Now, I understand the Labour leader has yet to reply to that invitation, but this is beyond disappointing, as Labour has an opportunity to deliver a Westminster reset on tackling child poverty after they win this election, which they certainly, judging by the opinion polls in England, they certainly are going to do that down south. However, not only has
Not only has Sir Keir Starmer failed to do so thus far in the campaign, but he is also vowing to adopt the same approach to public policy and spending as the Conservatives. Now, this will do nothing to alleviate child poverty, and instead will shrink household budgets even more, particularly for low-income families. Now, Carol Mockin once again spoke about listening to the experts. Now, Labour MSPs can try... Hold on a minute. Labour MSPs can try to defend Sir Keir all they want, but urge them to listen to this quote from the Director of the Institute for Fiscal Studies, Paul Johnson. Last week he said, and I quote, "Neither party, the Labour and Conservative Party, is really addressing the big problems that they will face if they win the election." He went on to say that the numbers that we've got from the Chancellor, which the Labour Party have not demurred from at all, imply big spending cuts over the next 5 years. Now, the IFS reckon these Tory and Labour Party plans would mean a massive £18 billion of cuts. And now, another think tank puts that figure closer to £33 billion of cuts. Now, this is vital money being taken away from Scotland's public services, meaning less money for the NHS and schools, less money to tackle poverty, and less money to help families with the cost of living crisis. Now, Presiding Officer, both Rishi Sunak and Sir Keir Starmer are committed to imposing even deeper cuts to the public services. Now, that's not my assessment, but that is the assessment of independent figures. Now, what's more, Save the Children published a tweet this morning, and I quote, they say that child poverty has been largely absent from the general election debate so far, there is no issue more important for governments to get to grips with. Now, Liam Kerr, in his contribution earlier on, spoke about 17 years of the SNP government and 25 years of devolution when he spoke about child poverty. But, Mr Kerr, 4.3 million children living in poverty in the UK is hardly a ringing endorsement for the Union. Now, sadly, the issue of child poverty continues to be at the top of the agenda in my constituency. And just this week, it was reported in the Greenock Telegraph that record numbers of families are seeking the help of children in poverty in Inverclyde, proof that the Tory cost of living crisis is making life harder for families. But sadly, after this election, no matter which of those two parties actually wins, the fact there's going to be at least £18 billion worth of cuts coming from them is not going to help Scotland, it's not going to help the UK, and it's certainly not going to help my constituents in the Greenock and Inverclyde constituency. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to closing speeches, and I call first Maggie Chapman, around 6 minutes. Ms Chapman.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Poverty is a slow violence that strikes children and those who care for them to the heart, in their bodies, their minds, their hopes, their dreams and their futures. It is possible to change that, however, for hundreds of thousands of children in Scotland, and if it is possible, then I believe we must do it. Rowan Williams, then Archbishop of Canterbury, wrote in his afterword to A Good Childhood, the original landmark report for the Children's Society, he wrote saying, "Love is at the centre of a child's needs." By love, he explained, he meant not just warm feelings, but, and I quote, "long-term commitment to someone else's well-being as something that matters profoundly to one's own well-being." By that definition, what we are called to do here is to love. For our commitment to the well-being of Scotland's children matters profoundly to us, to each of us as individuals, and to the collective moral legitimacy of this place. We must not treat challenges like exceptions, excuses for failure. A just UK-wide response to the COVID pandemic could have lessened inequality instead of increasing it. The so-called cost of living crisis, popularly blamed on war in Ukraine, is in reality a cost of greed opportunity, with both energy and food corporations making record profits. For we are now in a permanent state of exception. Our climate-changed future will bring more shortages, more extremes of cold and heat, of rain and drought, more conflicts, quite possibly more pandemics, striking the unprotected with the hardest blows. All are reasons to act, not excuses for failure. And the co-benefits of principled action, of investment in children's futures, of preventative spend instead of only dealing with damage, are all potentially immense. We can be healing our planet as we heal the wounds of poverty-ridden childhoods. It is a daunting task, but we must act now and act together. We must be brave, radical, creative, revolutionary. Again, I commend the Commission's final recommendations that we've heard so much about this afternoon. Their recommendations for cross-party action, for consensus building, with civil society and, crucially, with the ultimate experts, the families, parents, children and young people who know in their own lives what it is to live in poverty. We must do all we can now while we are here, but we must also give children and their carers, present and future generations, the tools they need to hold successive governments and public bodies to account. A Human Rights Act for Scotland can contain those tools. For human rights are not only about voting, about fair trials, about freedom of protest or freedom of speech. They are also about the most fundamental aspects of human life, about health and housing, food, education, being at work, about the air that we breathe, the water that we drink, about the right to learn and the right to play. So I could not let this afternoon's debate go by without asking the Scottish Government to reaffirm its commitment to bringing in the promised Human Rights Bill. We need to make use of all of the levers we have to tackle child poverty, but we also need to ensure that we have the routes to remedy when a child's right to food, education, a home, family life, or any of the other rights we hope the bill could include are not realised. We must have mechanisms of enforcing the provision of basic standards for all. And we must ensure that we support children and young people and their families and communities to understand and know what their rights are, so they may better realise them. A Human Rights Act for Scotland can be central to delivering all of that. And living not in poverty must certainly be one of the ultimate goals of us all achieving our human rights. I would like to end, Presiding Officer, with some stark words from the very end of the last century. They come from a member of a lone parents group in Glasgow and were quoted in Poverty firsthand. The children the Speaker was talking about will be adults now, perhaps still in Scotland, perhaps with children of their own, perhaps flourishing, perhaps not. The Speaker was probably, possibly, their mother, perhaps their father, maybe another lone caregiver. But they said this about those children, and I quote, "They should have a childhood, and they don't have a childhood now." Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call Michael Mara, around 7 minutes. Mr Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The First Minister began this debate today by hoping to set aside the general election context, which I know will be taking up an awful lot of time of MSPs at current moments, a fevered atmosphere that we're all working within. But elections are, of course, a time unnecessarily and rightly of promises, of setting out intent, telling people what it is you would do with the chance to serve should you be granted the honour of doing so. And I have to say that the part of the conversation today, I think, has turned around this idea about what the promises and the assurances that we, as different parties at different times, have given people and whether we have followed them through. And many colleagues, I think, across parties have been keen to point out the many other driving, number one, defining priorities of the 17 long years of this SNP government, the poverty-related attainment gap as wide as ever and the policy abandoned. Climate targets, laws set, targets celebrated, limited action, targets abandoned. The National Drugs Death Mission. The death figures today, Presiding Officer, up 8%, still four times higher than anywhere else in the UK. And the First Minister rightly has an opportunity now in taking on the role of leadership, the chance to set out his own intent, his own vision for the country. And I know that he has been delayed in some respects in doing so by the events of the election. But he has been at the very heart of this government for those last 17 years. And these things are his responsibility too. And I know that that will weigh on him. And of course, the drugs death figures published today are a very complex symptom of poverty itself. These are deaths of despair, of discrimination and of deprivation. They are driven, they are very tightly correlated with relation to poverty, and more so in Scotland than in other parts of the UK. And we should reflect in terms of there, not just in terms of this is not the immediate symptom of child poverty, but for many it's the end point. This is what happens when children are brought up in poverty and many of them lose their lives. And so I am also, I think, in fulsome agreement through the course of this debate with the First Minister that there is a very strong Westminster context to what we discussed today. And I think we would all acknowledge that that is the case. And we do know that there are 100,000 children kept out of poverty, that the language used by the Scottish Government in their own analysis. We know that the Scottish Child Payment is fighting against the prevailing trend. It's fighting against a context that is very difficult to swim against in the tide there. We have an economy in this country that is built in favour of the few, and it tends towards chaos, and frankly, at the moment, we seem to have stagnation being trumpeted as some kind of triumph on behalf of the Prime Minister at the moment. The fact that we have one in four children under that economy and under the policies of all collective governments in poverty in this country is scandalous. And the poor in this country are markedly worse off than the poor in almost any other part of Europe. And the cuts to social security that have been made since 2010 are one of the biggest drivers of that issue, one of the biggest continuous drivers. So we do need desperately change in government in Westminster, desperately. And the sooner it happens, the better. We do need a new policy approach. In one moment, we need a new policy approach. We need new values of decency, and we need a shared common purpose across these islands. Please.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for taking intervention? Can I welcome the approach that he's taken to his closing remarks so far? If he also therefore agrees that social security and the reduction of that is one of the biggest drivers of poverty, with respect, I've yet to hear from Labour what would change when it comes to social security. Not getting people looking to work, that's a different set of policies which we can have a discussion about another time. But the intent seems at the moment to keep the rate clause and to keep others, which are the policies he's just raised against.
Michael Marr, I can give you the time back.
Thank you very much. And I appreciate the intervention from the Cabinet Secretary. She is right to say that these are big and very significant issues. We on this, in the Labour Party, want to see that two-child cap removed. We want to see that done as soon as possible. And we want to see that as part of a fundamental review of universal credit. Because the First Minister also said in his opening statement, and I quote, "The fiscal envelope in which we operate is material to how we challenge child poverty." That goes for every government. And it would be irresponsible of this party, just as it would be on the part of the SNP, to set out commitments that they cannot afford to make. So we will treat that, and rightly, in the round. And it is a moral issue. It's a question of priorities. Of course it is. And we would rightly be challenged by other parties on how we set out that priority. But I believe that we will fundamentally, as we have done before, change the life circumstances of children in this country. So I would say, when one of the backbenchers from the SNP said, trust me, we did good things in the past and that just won't cut it. I think it's incumbent on all of us to look at the evidence, to look at the evidence of what did happen. And we see at the moment the evidence from the Poverty and Inequality Commission, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, Save the Children, all sounding a very loud alarm that our 2030 targets for ending child poverty are at very serious risk, unless there is a significant change in the approach of the government, and rightly in combination with other parties in making those changes. Because the best guide, frankly, when we talk about promises being made, is what has been done in the past. And I thought that was summed up very well by Alec Rowley, and frankly, in a speech where I thought was redolent and heavy with hope, a word that isn't actually much used around some of these issues. And we have to treat that hope carefully. The minimum wage one day did seem to be impossible to many people, and it was realised. And we did introduce working families tax credits, which lifted 1 million children across this country out of poverty. He's right to highlight the fact that colleges in this country could actually have a significant impact on the life chances of young people, not just by giving them money, but by giving them focus and giving them purpose, by understanding what they're for. Because college principals tell me day after day they still don't know what their purpose is and the job they're meant to be given by this government. Beatrice Wishart pointed out the local authorities and the cuts that are being made there, and I thought made a very important contribution. Yes, I will in a second. Very important contribution around gender and the gender analysis. Thank you.
Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you,
the member for giving way, and I note his comments earlier on about drivers of poverty and hope. And the member will know that one of the key drivers of child poverty is imprisonment. And we know that, broadly speaking, imprisonment doesn't work. And I'm interested that Labour have recently been saying that they will fix prisons crisis by driving through a prison building programme. So I wonder if, given his comments on hope, how that will help child poverty.
Michael Mara, I can give you the time back.
I think it's fair to say that the prison estate in this country is a very significant problem and is recognised, I think, by the front bench of the government. There's absolutely no idea, no chance that we can continue to have the justice system in even a better form that exists at the moment without renewing the prison estate across the country. It's going to cost a lot of money, there's no doubt about it. It's a long-term project. But I would reject any idea that we don't have to replace some of the prison estate and provide better quality, high-quality accommodation for people at all parts of our communities. I would reject that. In closing, Presiding Officer, I would say that it's absolutely vital that we continue to have as much consensus as we can across these issues, that we recognise the fiscal and the challenging restraints that we exist with underneath, and that we make the right choices together about how we change child poverty and change the outcomes for young people for the future of Scotland.
Thank you, Mr Mara. I now call Miles Briggs, around 8 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And there's a great Scottish saying that it takes a village to raise a child, and I agree. And the First Minister mentioned children and young people are our future, and they absolutely are. And we need to all be wanting to see, and I believe we do, the best start in life for our young people to realise their potential. Now, as Douglas Ross and other speakers have said, I very much welcome this debate and the opportunity for Parliament to discuss the policies which have collectively been supported across all parties to try to address the levels of child poverty in Scotland. And the issues of child poverty, as we have heard today, are multifaceted and indeed, as George Adam mentioned, intergenerational. As a member of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee, I promoted the committee undertaking an inquiry into addressing child poverty through parental employment. The working groups and the lived experience groups which we set up and the visits which we undertook, I think, helped shape that report which Parliament debated recently, especially to the Western Isles. I think the parents we met there really demonstrated how they were making ends meet by working many jobs, and some of the transport issues they faced, the housing issues they faced, were just as important as anything. In the time I have today, though, I wanted to focus my comments on housing policy and a few other issues which haven't been discussed. As housing outcomes, I think, are one of the key things we need to make sure are also included in the government's drive to address child poverty in this country. And I make no apology, as I did earlier, for consistently highlighting the unacceptable issue of children and young people and pregnant women being placed in temporary accommodation by councils. As Crisis state in their briefing, homelessness is the most acute form of poverty. We often speak about adverse childhood experiences in debates, and what can be more adverse than becoming homeless as a child or a young person, or being born into homelessness? So what do we know about children and young people experiencing homelessness? Well, over 16,000 children officially are homeless in Scotland today, the highest on record. Households with children spend longer in temporary accommodation than the national average. The research suggests that children in temporary accommodation often arrive at school tired, late, hungry, struggling to maintain friendships, and are likely to experience greater mental health and behavioural concerns. Homelessness amongst young people aged 16 to 24 is more than twice the rate of that for older people, with young women being disproportionately affected. And as Douglas Ross stated, one in 20 households in Scotland now contain someone under 25 who state that they previously were looked after by a local authority. Young people are also more likely to experience hidden homelessness. We heard just this morning at the local government committee that around 12% of all students and young people report experiencing homelessness during the course of their studies. So what more can be done? Well, the Homelessness Prevention Review Group put forward some welcome recommendations around homelessness services being designed to meet their needs of young people, and I welcome many of them. The Housing Bill currently before Parliament contains measures to ensure services work together to prevent homelessness, and we all welcome those. But actually having an outcome is something I think we need to make sure is focused on. And I welcome the comments by Beatrice Wisher around the negative impact which homelessness has in tackling poverty, but also the lifelong stigma which homelessness can often also build. I recently visited the Rock Trust here in Edinburgh to see a new policy which they've put in place called Upstream. It's working to actually have a preventative model by identifying young people at risk of homelessness in the first place. I don't know if the First Minister has had a chance to see it or visit them, but they are piloting the projects in schools here in Edinburgh, West Lothian and Perth and Kinross. So I certainly hope he'll look at that, because it's something I want to see in the housing bill, which will make a huge difference. Again, with community advice services. If I can get some time back, yes, absolutely.
Paul McLennan.
Very quickly, I know Mr Briggs and I have a meeting coming up this week, happy to discuss the points that he's raised. I also visited the Rock Trust and the fantastic work that they're doing on that. So happy to discuss the points that we raised. I know we've got a meeting, as I said, during the week, but Rock Trust are doing some fantastic work, as you mentioned.
Yep. Miles Briggs.
No, I absolutely agree with the Housing Minister. And where I hope we will all be adding value is for that housing bill to be shaped by these sorts of projects which aren't currently being funded. Again, with Community Housing Advice, for example, a partnership with Children First, they're reaching out to families in need of advice in a school setting to make sure that that early intervention approach actually happens. Now, that said, as an MSP for Lothian, I'm seriously concerned that we are struggling, and Edinburgh City Council is struggling, to find the solutions needed to address the housing crisis here in the capital, with 25% of all children living in temporary accommodation now here in the City of Edinburgh. It is important that we see a very bespoke solution for Edinburgh, and that is something I'll be also arguing when the housing bill is brought forward. The Scottish Government declaring a housing emergency is a first welcome step forward, but we now need to see the Government bringing forward workable solutions. Presiding Officer, access to early childcare and supporting vulnerable young people has been mentioned by a number of speakers this afternoon. My colleague Ros McCall made some very important points in relation to how early years childcare policy is failing to deliver for parents and families, highlighted in the Audit Scotland report that found that childcare sector remains fragile despite the expansion of free childcare. My colleague Liam Kerr made some very valid and important points, particularly in relation to children and young people missing from education, and the fact that this isn't even been recorded in Scotland. There is a growing concern that we are seeing a hidden generation of young people not in education or employment. Two important issues which weren't raised during the debate but I wanted to touch upon were levels of poverty among Scotland's ethnic minority communities, which remain disproportionately higher than the general population. Statistics show that one in five are living in relative poverty. That's 43% of minority ethnic children here in Scotland. So that is an area we need to never make sure is neglected or not, doesn't go specifically with the bespoke solution around policies government are bringing forward. Clearly, there are specific contributing factors which are negatively impacting on this group, but we need to make sure that the focus is there. Health has also not been touched on by many members, but I am specifically concerned around some of the reports which we've been seeing post-pandemic and where statistically children's health is not being addressed. I recently co-chaired an event here in Parliament with Jackie Bailey to launch the Royal College of Paediatric and Children's Health report titled Worried and Waiting. That report is deeply concerning. It suggests that 48.9% of children now in Scotland are waiting over 12 weeks to see a paediatric specialist. Here in Lothian, again, 69% of children are waiting for more than 12 weeks. The Health Minister isn't here for this debate, but it's something when he came along to that, he was going to report back to members, which we haven't received, but it is quite clear that we are facing a crisis in paediatric health services in Scotland, and something which, although not mentioned, the government need to take responsibility for. Interestingly, looking at those statistics, in 2012, just 1% of children waited over 12 weeks. Now almost 50%. So we need to see action, and that needs to be part of any solutions and work the government say they want to take forward. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think today has demonstrated there is cross-party consensus that the best way to tackle child poverty is to ensure that parents are in fair work and can access employment opportunities. The First Minister today has made clear in taking up the job of First Minister that eradicating child poverty is the single most important policy objective for his government. We welcome this and we want to work with the government to try to make sure that priority is actually achieved. And we are ambitious for that commitment to be matched with bold action. But simply setting a target here in this Parliament isn't going to deliver that. We need to see the outcomes delivered on the ground, our health service, our councils funded and given the support they need to achieve that. On these benches, we will support the government and offer suggestions. But certainly, I hope today has given us an opportunity to see that that challenge is not an easy one, but it's one I hope the government can actually make progress on. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Briggs. And I call Shirley Ann Somervilles to wind up the debate. Cabinet Secretary, a generous 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The First Minister quite rightly laid out in his opening remarks that eradicating child poverty should be a joint endeavour. And I will very much, in my closing remarks, hope to again reach out across the Chamber and indeed those out with the Chamber in this endeavour that we all share. He also importantly, I think, raised the context in which we do that. And I think it is important, as we look to solutions, that we do need to recognise the parameters in which we do that. The austerity, which has now been ongoing for some time, the Brexit challenges that we have, and the cost of living crisis. These affect different people, different communities in different ways, but their effect is tangible, it's real, and it is some of the main drivers of poverty that we see in our society today. The First Minister also asks us to work collaboratively. And I think, and we have heard indeed that across the Chamber, I hope at agreement that that is indeed the only way that we will be able to tackle these systemic issues such as child poverty or indeed the climate emergency. A member pointed out earlier on in the debate that the Parliament is often at its best when it comes together, and one of those times was indeed when we passed the Act involving the child poverty targets. I think that also is a lesson and a warning to all of us as well. After this debate, where we have came together to seek consensus, to agree that eradicating child poverty is a joint endeavour and we should do so together, what then do we do in terms of the action? Because as we've seen with the climate change actions that follow on from the climate change targets, we often come together as a chamber to support a target or support a piece of legislation to drive change. But when people come forward with actions, then people start to step away. And I think that's a challenge for the government that we must rise to, and we have not been blameless in that in the past. But as a minority government, there is a challenge there for all of us to see whether we can rise to that occasion. So how do we take those actions forward collectively together? And I look forward to Douglas Ross suggesting how we can do just that.
Douglas Ross.
To the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. When she said her government had not been blameless, can she explain and expand to the public where they have failed in this issue so we can all understand the issues that the Scottish Government is tackling where they themselves have failed?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as the First Minister has made clear, and I've made clear many times presiding in this chamber, the levels of poverty within Scotland remain too high. And as the government, we obviously have to take a level of responsibility for that, because regardless of the context that we are in, we are the government and we must do everything that we can. And I'll come on to the actions that we are taking, but we will always take responsibility and have the shared endeavour to see what more we can do. When we look at the amendments that are taken forward by the Conservatives and Labour today, I think they also provide some suggestions on ways forward, but also some of the dangers in which we may still get into as we discuss this issue. Miles Briggs, and I know he has had this interest for some time, has discussed housing within his remarks. One of the areas, the challenges that we have, indeed pointed out by crisis, that the biggest issue when it comes to some of the homelessness challenges that are here in Scotland is the freeze in local housing allowances designated by Westminster. That's an example of the context where we can come together, Miles Briggs and I hope, and indeed he will, with Mr McClellan later this week to discuss homelessness. But we must do that within the context to see how at different levels of government we can work on that. The Conservatives also, within a variety of speeches, suggested ways in which we should be spending more money on education, on colleges, breakfast and lunches, on housing. Many demands for the additional spending that will take forward. And we've heard some of that as well from Labour. Indeed, it's in the motion, more money in housing, the Scottish Welfare Fund, fuel poverty, other examples within speeches. I'm also quite intrigued, Presiding Officer, in what's coming out of the Scottish Government motion if the Labour amendment was passed. What they take out is warning about Westminster austerity and the threat that that poses to our goals on child poverty. It takes out the fact that you could take 40,000 more children out of poverty with an essentials guarantee and a rape clause. It takes out calls on the UK Government to work with the Scottish Government to follow our lead in the ambitious anti-poverty action. So I think as we look to the proposals that are coming forward, there is, I think, something to tell from what can come out of what a party is wishing to pass in Parliament, not just what they are wishing to add through their amendments. And the issue around what will happen at a UK government level is an exceptionally important one. It's been raised before, but I think it's important to stress again that the Institute of Fiscal Studies have discussed a conspiracy of silence between both Labour and the Tories on the plans for cuts. The fiscal rules, they say, will have to lead to £18 billion of sharp cuts if these are taken forward. That is a challenge for any incoming government, regardless of their colour. And it's also important to see how other parties deal with issues in this area. So, the Scottish Government is providing £1.4 billion worth of support to low-income families with children. That is approximate to the amount raised through the work we do on progressive taxation. That demonstrates why progressive taxation and the decisions that have been taken by this government have been so important. And they have been some of the decisions that have been criticised by others, both in the Conservatives, which I would expect, but also, I think, disappointingly, from Scottish Labour as well. So again, there is a challenge to all of us in how we rise to the occasion of the demands for more money, but also how we can improve the situation within the Scottish Parliament by raising money through progressive taxation. And those two challenges, I think, are integral to how we tackle child poverty. That UK fiscal context, where we have a 9% cut in the Scottish Government budget, almost 60% reduction in financial transactions in 24-25, and a budget in 23-24 that was nearly 5% worth less than when it was set. That's a challenging concept, which then brings us on to what we can do within this chamber. Because we may be in the midst of an election campaign now, but it won't be long, and I don't know whether this is good or bad news to people, but it won't be long until our attention is turned to the next budget round for the Scottish Government budget. We are now a minority government. So the asks that come from across the chamber on how we wish to spend money, our door will absolutely be open. But those discussions also need to be about where that money comes from. Now, we always say that every year, but the ability for every party to genuinely impact on a budget in a minority situation is real. But they must come forward with costed proposals for that.
Miles Briggs.
I thank the member for taking this intervention. One of the hardest things, and the Cabinet Secretary knows about these concerns of mine, is access to officials to actually look at the data which the government have, where money all of a sudden is found by ministers, usually to keep the Greens on board in the past. But would the Cabinet Secretary then agree that civil servants should be made available to all parties in this Parliament to discuss all the monies government have access to?
Cabinet Secretary.
All the ministers within this government would absolutely welcome the opportunity to sit down with Miles Briggs and others alongside our officials to be able to discuss the difficult choices that would have to be made, because with every request for more money, as the Scottish Green colleagues will know, becomes difficult decisions. And that is something which every party now has to face up to. Because if we're looking to consensus that leads to action, then that does not just require action from the government, but also from other parties as well. Presiding officer, a number of people mentioned the Poverty and Inequality Commission comments, and they're quite right to do so. They are raising a challenge, not again just for government, but for all of us, and how we can work in a cross-party agreement with civil society to develop a strategy for the child poverty targets. They're quite right to do so, and I welcome the work that we can take forward with the Commission to see how that can be done. They've also challenged government, but I think, again, as a minority government, it's a challenge for all of us, about how we should reprioritise funding to ensure that the necessary resources are made available to deliver both for existing commitments and future actions. We are absolutely stand ready for that challenge, and I ask members across the chamber to do so as well. If I can turn briefly to some of the comments that have been made by others during the debate, Maggie Chapman, as always, gave a very thoughtful speech, particularly her closing remarks around how we must look to tackle child poverty and the climate crisis. These two are not mutually exclusive. They are shared endeavours, and we must look to do that. And I absolutely will give, once again, a firm commitment to the Human Rights Act. This government does remain absolutely committed to a strong Human Rights Act. We are, of course, limited due to the fact that we are in a pre-election period and what we can see on these issues, but I look forward to carrying on the discussions that I've had with Maggie Chapman on that in some time. Beatrice Wishart, I think, raised a very important point on gender inequality and gender poverty, and she's quite right to do so. It's something that I take very seriously. Alec Rowley mentioned the role of local government, Scottish Government and UK Government, and he is quite right again to point out to what we must do on all levels of government, how we all rise to that challenge. I would say to Mr Rowley, and indeed to other colleagues, the invitation to meet with ministers on solutions is not just for the spokespeople on the front benches, but for all of those with good ideas, and my door is always open to my fellow Fifer if he wishes to discuss the issues on child poverty, and non-Fifers are indeed allowed meetings to discuss this as well, presiding officer. But he does raise also, and members on the Labour benches have done so in the past, about what Labour has done, the right to do so. My challenge to Labour is take tax credits, for example. They're currently being dismantled by the current Tory government, because what Labour can give sometimes, the Tories will take away in the next government that comes along. There is a danger in depending on a Labour government, presiding officer, for your solutions, because even if they do live up to some expectations, and some of us may question where they are on some of these commitments currently, they can certainly be taken away when the next Tory government comes along. Emma Roddick gave a very powerful speech, as always, on the impact of homelessness. I think Paul McLennan has already reached out, as he knows, he's probably the most approachable minister within government, to suggest a meeting, and we look forward to working on the housing bill with my colleague Ms Roddick on that as well. Presiding officer, we as a government remain absolutely committed to our child poverty targets. I think, I hope, from what we've heard today, the whole Parliament does as well. But that's why it's important that we work across government, not just within social justice, but as colleagues have challenged us to do, in health, in education, indeed right across government and all cabinet secretaries to work together on that endeavour. We must also do that across the chamber and also across Scotland on all different levels of government, UK, Scottish government and our local authorities. If we do so, if we rise to that challenge, if we genuinely do work together to look for solutions, then we can eradicate child poverty once and for all. And surely, presiding officer, that is all what we got into politics for. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Scottish Government priorities eradicating child poverty. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of business motion 13579. In the name of Jamie Hepburn, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on Jamie Hepburn to move the motion.
Move, presiding officer.
Thank you, Minister. No member has asked to speak to the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 13579 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed, and I am minded under I'm minded to accept a motion without notice under Rule 11.2.4 of Standing Orders that decision time be brought forward to now, and I invite the Minister to move the motion.
Officer.
Thank you. The question is that decision time be brought forward to now. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and there are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 13566.3 in the name of Douglas Ross, which seeks to amend Motion 13566 in the name of John Swinney on Scottish Government priorities eradicating child poverty, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to vote, and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.